It is your PrisonPlanet.tv memberships that fund so much of what we do here on this operation. And then we're more than happy for the TV show after it's aired live, then be leaked out onto the web to tens of millions of people. That's our goal. Dykes' report coming up on this Wednesday edition, the 27th day of February 2013, where he breaks down the incredible open threat of Napolitano that, hey, don't cut our Homeland Security funding or the terrorist will strike. We mentioned some of this yesterday, but it's amazing. And you know, let us spy on you without warrants or the terrorist will strike while they're running the real terrorist networks overseas. We're going to be breaking all of that down coming up in the next segment. And we are also going to have Katherine Albrecht, Dr. Katherine Albrecht, who's one of the leading researchers and voices out there exposing the smart slave grid, the smart meters, the RFID, the smart cards, the biometric thumb scanning, the drone robot takeover. So we're going to be breaking all of that down with her today here in studio. In studio with Katherine Albrecht. She's scheduled for an hour, but we might have her for a little bit longer to take your phone calls. I do want to take calls as well today here. We have a bunch of key articles up at Infowars.com because the Huffington Post and others have been running hoaxes that Hitler was actually kind of a nice guy and didn't take any guns. Well, they say he's a bad guy, but he was pro-gun, so they're trying to demonize us. Eyewitness, yes, the Nazis did confiscate guns. Plus, we have the Nuremberg trial and the Nazi gun laws. That's up at Infowars.com. New York's seven-round law bans most firearms. That's right. Kurt Nimmo has a report. I mean, there's your gun ban right there, and they're arresting people. It's happening. They're persecuting law-abiding citizens with no criminal record with their unconstitutional law that is a fraud. Explosive report, 98% of newborn babies are genetically screened. Oh, yeah, they're taking your blood. It's a new report. Finally, the mainstream media admits it, but I told you this 15 years ago with the documents leaked out of the Pentagon via San Antonio. You know, just groundbreaking information. No big deal, though, because I'm a conspiracy theorist. Big Sis threatens terror attack over sequestration cuts or government castrating the public cuts. Illinois state rep compares gun control to population control. DHS to release 10,000 illegals while building new detention centers. Key article by Paul Joseph Watson that we are going to be getting into in great detail as well today. In fact, I think I forgot to print that article or I missed it in the stack, so we'll print that now for everybody out there watching on TV, what I do on my computer. It's kind of cool. You know, you see everything I'm doing in here. I like that. It's total transparency so that I can just communicate everything. That's why the office listens to the show, because I sit here and I guess kind of have a public office meeting here on the air as well. I saw my stories, but I missed my featured news stack. Maybe it was mixed in with the others. But there is so much going on that we're going to be breaking down here today. We've got a bunch of special reports that we're going to be premiering here. Boner slams move to release detained immigrants when he's trying to release and legalize them all anyways with Obama. This is all theater. I'm going to be breaking that down. We've also got, again, Napolitano trying to hold us all captive, give her more money or the terrorists will get us. Pretty obvious who stands to gain from the terrorism. Pretty obvious who has the motive if you have an IQ above room temperature and know what the word motive means. We also have the ABC News report that we covered yesterday that drudgereport.com is linked to last night and today. So it's now basically breaking nationwide, a local news, WAAY, ABC News, Alabama. City wants power to disarm individuals during any crisis. So there you go. It is all coming up today and more. I am Alex Jones, your host. By the way, I happen to be listening to Howard Stern this morning, monitoring it on my XM since I was on the show yesterday. And they said one of the most popular guests ever. They have a vote with the Stern fan club. I think they said 79%. of the people voted that I was the best thing on the show yesterday. We'll be right back. America, Europe, and most of the world is being held captive by a private mafia cartel that has seized control of the world's financial systems and controls the planet, first through fractional reserve banking, and now through derivatives kiting that makes any other form of Ponzi scheme pale in significance. And that is the system that we are facing. That is the big enchilada. That is the key to the lock to free our society, is that we have private megacorporations, only about six in most of the Fortune 500 are their interlocking subsidiaries. The few that aren't are being forced to sell out or being mopped up right now. It is a global corporate consolidation dictatorship into one huge combine. And its goal is to make us serfs and forcibly reduce population. And many say, well, go ahead and reduce population. There are too many people, because you live in an urban environment that distorts reality and makes you think that there's too many fish in the sea. But you could go 20 miles in the sea and not see a single fish till you come to a coral reef and see tens of thousands. It's the same thing with cities and megacities and megapolises. But I digress. These globalists have the symbol of energy, money, digital and physical, which has no real worth, but that we will work, fight, and die, kill, sell our bodies, sell our ideas, sell our children into slavery to survive, or more importantly, in the modern age of mind control, to sit high on the pedestal in the parrot tree. That's all parrots care about, is sitting the highest in the tree in a sign of status. Like chimpanzees, the king chimpanzee, the leader of the troops, sitting high up on the hill, looking down on the others. The fake status, the primitive ambrosia or opiate of the animal class. Well, I have the body of an animal, but the mind that is the key to the universe. And so do you, ladies and gentlemen. So do you. And don't let them ever tell you you're crap. Don't let the globalists ever tell you you're worthless. They're trying to tell you that so you believe that, so you never develop, because they're threatened by you developing. They know the power of the individual because they've taken over. And they know their power. And they know you're even more powerful. All right, let me get into all the news here. We're being held hostage by this global mafia combine. They hold us hostage and say, give up all your rights or Al-Qaeda will kill you. They're doing that again. We're going to cover that in a moment. They hold us hostage and say, sign on to our 1.5 quadril. It's more like 2 quadril now. That number's about 2 years old out of the Washington Post. Our side of the debt, they tell us, that we don't owe is the 644 trill. That's what they say Americans owe of that 1.5 quadril. And Dr. Tarpley, who's an economist, has broken that down as well. Let's get Tarpley back on about the economy and what's the meltdown in Europe. See if you can get him on tomorrow, or Adams is in on Friday or on the Sunday show. Thanks. But specifically, you got to tell him what he's on about, or he'll cover whatever he wants, which is fine. But I want to get into the meltdown in Europe, where he sees that going, where the current economic situation is, because he always wants to cover how we fix it. And I get his view on how we fix it. My point is they're not following that view. So he side issue, just make sure when you set him up, he knows that. Or I guess he listens to the show sometimes, he tells me he does, so maybe he hears that. I'll just say, hey, Tarpley, come on about this, and then it's about that. So that's why he hadn't been on lately, just because it's always like a wild card, but I do enjoy having him on. The point is, there is 1.5 quadrillion, 1,500 trillion, more like the actual number I saw recently, it's gone up by another 400 or so, so 1.9 quadril. And the derivatives has increased since 2008. And they've got new global bubbles on real estate. But that's still only, what, here in the U.S., 50, 60, billion dollars. And if you add it all up together, all the real estate that's got problems, $300, $400 billion. How are we being signed on to trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions? It's an artificial wall of fraud they built up to then make us think we're signed on to it, this big giant ball and chain. And I guess if you look at all the real commitments we've been signed on to that are actually our debts, $16 trillion roughly, federal debt. If you add in, I guess, the commercial real estate and the rest of it, it's in the multi-trillions. But still, that could easily be bailed out and fixed. But we've been signed on to prop up the 1.5 quadrillion, 600 plus trillion of that, we're told, is our debt. And it's amazing. I mean, these numbers are even hard to grasp for myself. And they're holding us hostage with that, saying, you will do this or too big to fail, the whole economy goes down, as the economy goes down anyways. And as they use the bailout, $85 billion a month, 40-plus billion of that just to derivatives, and most of that's foreign derivatives. And if you're a new listener, you're like, well, where's the proof? Just type in $85 billion a month to foreign banks, half of it to derivatives only. This is what's going on. And now they're holding us hostage, saying, we're going to release all these thousands of, many of them violent illegal aliens under sequestration because we don't have money to hold them. When I've seen articles in the Houston Chronicle where they've released hundreds of thousands in a single year, over 200,000 illegal aliens, many of which were violent felons, aggravated felons, here in the United States, just in Texas alone. It's routine. The feds just release these people anyways and deport a paltry amount, basically a show, and raid a few meatpacking plants a year and have a big show that they're doing something. I mean, remember Homeland Security under Bush hired illegal aliens to build the wall, the show wall. So that's what's going on here. We're being held hostage. When we come back from break, I'm going to play Aaron Dykes' report that ties into Big Sis threatens terror attack over sequestration cuts. And she's saying, you don't cut our tens upon tens upon tens of billions. What's the total budget of Homeland Security? Something like $80 billion or something ridiculous? I mean, they're paying for helicopters that cost $400,000. And they say, oh, it's free federal money. The helicopters that the feds are paying for sheriff departments and police departments to get all over the country. Katie outside Houston got one last year and crashed it on the test flight. Yeah, there it is. Napolitano's speech to intimidate a mere $85 billion budget cuts with the threat of new terror attacks. Yeah, she's trying to intimate that if you don't give her the extra $85 billion, that the terrorists are going to get us any minute, and you've got the very terrorist working for NATO and the globalist and for the Secretary of State, now approved, Hagel, publicly, and then it's hiding in plain view. Just like the troops, opium production went from 10% to 93% within just a few years of the liberation of Afghanistan. And then we talk about it, and it comes out, so they go, oh, yeah, on Fox News and CNN and ABC Nightly News, yeah, we grow the opium and ship it into America and Europe, but if we catch you with it, you're going to jail. Next news story. And they did that because the troops were complaining and saying, we're being told to help grow the opium, and it's being trucked off to air bases, and this is incredible. I mean, if you get caught in your car with heroin, folks, you're going to be lucky if you get 5-6 years probation, even if it's a usable amount. I've looked at the different sentencing and what's been happening. Most of the time, you actually get a couple years in jail for being a user of a product the government grows and ships in. And you're like, well, that doesn't make sense. It makes perfect sense. They put you in their private prisons that are guaranteed 90% occupancy under state laws, and they ship something in that's addictive, that funds them, that people then rob folks' houses and things to buy the overpriced product because they've made it illegal in a black market. And then when they catch you using it, they make you a slave, a nonviolent slave, in one of their factories for 25 cents an hour, competing with everybody else. And so it's the instinct to hold us hostage. Give up your rights or there'll be drugs on the street they're shipping in. Give up your rights or Al-Qaeda will attack you that the globalists, the foreign banks that have hijacked us run. Give us total power or the economy will implode, too big to fail. And now, give us unlimited spending increases and more taxes. And they're already talking about more taxes this year after that. See, because after they get you, the debt's doubled since Obama's been in. And it's going to double again, faster and faster, and it's going to be more tax, or we're going to take your 401k. Now, that's already started. They're going to take everything. And always say, everything will collapse if we don't take your 401k. Everything will collapse if we don't raise your payroll tax. Everything will collapse if we don't double health care costs. Everything, while they're collapsing it, but collapsing it into their hands as a tool of making you poor. And now they're saying, we're going to release 10,000 illegal aliens while, PrisonPlanet.com article, building new detention centers. And I've always told you, because this is in Rex 84, congressional hearings, 1986. They're online, the whole hearings with Oliver North, the rest of it. Miami Herald, you name it. Senator Inouye saying, we will not touch upon that matter at this time with Congressman Jack Brooks in a bipartisan committee hearings, the Iran-Contra hearings, that they were going to build FEMA centers to put citizens in and prime them with illegals and then later legalize the illegals, turn them all loose, actually make them soldiers. The biggest part of the military is now illegals that are legalized, and put Americans, black, white, Hispanic, who aren't basically communist, in them. And you're like, but Oliver North was anti-communist. You don't get this, folks. He was anti-Iran, too, wasn't he? Shipping weapons to the Ayatollahs. Folks, when you figure out the triple, double games, it's full-spectrum dominance. The bankers run all of it. All of it. All the big institutions. They're trying to mop up the middle-sized things and systems they don't control. That's why the battle is on. They meant to already have this whole thing taken over by now. They're behind. They can be defeated. We'll be right back. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones. We're going to air this key report on the other side. All right. The video of this report is up at Infowars.com. Big Sis threatens terror attack over sequestration cuts. This is an act of terrorism. They have the motive to stage terror or allow terror attacks so that we allow them to take over our society, just like Hitler firebombed his own Reichstag. Here's Aaron Dykes.
Under sequestration, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, also part of DHS, will be forced to reduce detention and removal. Perhaps most critically, it would have serious consequences to the flow of trade and travel.
So the sequestration budget cuts are here, a measly $85 billion of automatic cuts because they couldn't agree on real budget cuts that will basically do nothing to the American budget. And yet in the news, we have Janet Napolitano, head of Homeland Security, openly making threats that if they dare touch her precious Homeland Security budget, there might be new terror attacks or there might be a new wave of immigrants illegally flooding across the border. Let's play a short clip of that right now.
Look, I don't think we can maintain the same level of security at all places around the country with sequester as without sequester. Threats from terrorism and the need to respond and recover from natural disasters do not diminish because of budget cuts.
Let's just call it for what it is. It's a veiled threat. It is terrorism, and we know who the real terrorists are. We've seen countless false flag events from 9/11 on down, from the phony underwear bomber scenario used to sell body scanners to the public, and of course, the setting up of Homeland Security itself to terrorize the people. We know what it is. The dictionary definition of terrorism is the systematic use of fear or terror as a means of coercion, and that's just what they're doing. And of course, Janet Napolitano says she's not trying to scare anyone. She just wants them to plan for what if there's not enough money for TSA to grow passengers, and what to do if there's longer lines and you have to wait to get on a plane, or if you're not able to make your flight.
Average wait times to clear customs will increase by as much as 50%, and at our busiest airports like Newark and JFK, LAX and O'Hare, peak wait times, which can reach over 2 hours, could easily grow to 4 hours.
Homeland Security and other national security figures, Napolitano on down, don't want the public to even think that these national security apparatuses can be targeted by budget cuts. So that's why they want to reiterate the fear. They admittedly did it during the Bush administration using their color-coded fear chart. Every time Bush was down in the polls, or that he faced re-election, or that the public was beginning to doubt that the war on terror was real. Now we see it again, as we already have in the Obama administration, the fear-mongering over checks won't go out, people are going to starve, people are going to go hungry. And then here's Napolitano adding on to that, that the country will break down and passengers will have to wait in lines, and the TSA won't be able to do its job, and it's not our fault if there's more terror attacks. Well, we know who's clearly behind the staged phony terror in this country. We also know that Homeland Security and TSA have never caught a real terrorist, especially at airports, and that the only terrorists they have set up and charged are those led by admitted FBI sting operations. But Napolitano wants you to think that her precious Homeland Security budget is untouchable and that they have a right to occupy and control the direction of this country. Of course, Homeland Security's real money comes through black budgets and is used for continuity of government operations, setting up of FEMA camps and a lot more. No one's even pretending to touch that money.
Under sequestration, immigration and customs enforcement would not be able to maintain the 34,000 detention beds as required by Congress. It would also reduce our investigative activities in areas like human smuggling.
They want you to be afraid of a wave of illegal immigration, even though they're admittedly planning to give amnesty to more than 11 million immigrants and pretty much openly don't do anything to restrict the border. In fact, Department of Justice and others give weapons to the drug cartels, allow them to ship in their drugs, and then launder the money on Wall Street. They just want to, again, control and instill fear in the American public. They're not going to do anything to stop illegal immigration one way or another, and they're certainly not going to stop terrorism, which they could just use to further their own agenda. We see through you, Janet Napolitano. We know that your odor comes from a defensive mechanism like a skunk or like a stink beetle to keep people away from your little precious jewel agency of Homeland Security, so they'll think they can't cut your budget, and you'll just excrete this defensive odor upon the people. Well, stop it. You're repugnant. You're repugnant to the Constitution. Get away from our Bill of Rights. Stop using it as your toilet paper. Signing off for InfoWars.com, I'm Aaron Dykes.
Hi, I'm Janet Napolitano, Secretary of Homeland Security. If you try to take our money that is rightfully ours, we will unleash a legion of terrorists on you, because we need our money to put our hands down your pants and create terror alerts and do all kinds of things to take away your freedoms and to pay for targets that look like pregnant women and old men defending their homes. Those are the real terrorists.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are live. Thank you so much for joining us. And I actually got about 7 hours sleep last night, so I am feeling really good right now. I want to take your phone calls ahead of Katherine Albrecht joining us. She's supposed to be in studio in about 30 minutes. Is she here? Has she arrived? Well, I look forward to having her here when she gets here. And at the same time, we will give the phone number out right now to get your take on all the news that's taking place. Specifically, holding us hostage. Give us more money or terrorist attack. Give us more money to foreign banks or we'll implode the economy. Give us more money. Don't cut one nickel out of any of the federal budget that actually gets bigger by hundreds of billions of dollars a year, or the terrorist will literally murder everybody. Give us more money or we have to give $85 billion to foreign banks. I mean, it's a joke how obvious and transparent all of this is. And I just want to be clear. Will you guys cue up that Boehner clip? Slams move to release detained immigrants. We're going to play that in a moment. And again, sounds like good rhetoric out of him. Because look, Mexico is a failed state. Upwards of 60,000 dead the last 5 years. Last time I checked, it was 59,000. Dead bodies found everywhere. Heads chopped off. Total tyranny. One of the most corrupt governments on earth. Probably after ours. Our government's just better at hiding it. Not for long. And, well, I mean, there it's just so lawless that they're just destroying everything. And that's what corruption will do. It'll grow and grow and grow and grow until, like locusts, the corrupt just can't control each other anymore, and they destroy all the mechanisms that produce the wealth. It's kind of like a goose that lays the golden eggs. A smart criminal government wants a big, fat, healthy goose because it's getting the eggs anyways. That's a boss hog type thing. No, that's not what's going on here. I don't like boss hog either. Because Boss Hogg isn't going to want me, you know, to be free. But still, Boss Hogg, if you give him, his money, he'll usually leave you alone. These guys don't want you making money. They want to be the only ones running the factories, running the systems. And why should they then have to produce for you? They have the instinct of dominators, the instinct of debilitators, the instinct of people that want blight and things rotting. And they destroy art, literature, culture. They destroy the family. They destroy everything that is of the greater angels in men. And they lower everything down. Ceausescu, we got a report coming up on this In fact, I'm going to get to this report. Get the report ready. I've got to cover this. I said I'd take calls, but not yet. Get the report ready, the quick comment by Boehner. And then I want to play the clip, the special report that David Knight just did up at one of the big gun rallies in Texas, in Dallas, with a famous survivor of Ceausescu, who then came to the U.S., became a lawyer, and battled him in the international courts before he ended up being overthrown by his own people. And they were a prosperous country, but it took the communists about a decade to really take over and really wreck things. And by the end, he had them trained to only have about 2 hours of power a day nationwide. And he had his own pleasure city that had, you know, power all the time. And his own giant golf courses, bowling alleys, everything. And they do it as a tool of total control. You understand? People are like, how could Obama raise taxes on poor people? That's so cold-blooded. Well, that's the plan. So let's go ahead and play Boehner. Here's Boehner.
The agency that enforces immigration laws in this country confirmed today that it is, at this moment, releasing hundreds of illegal immigrants from U.S. detention centers because it says with the sequestration, they can't afford to keep them. Is this what you intended?
This is very hard for me to believe, that they can't find cuts elsewhere in their agency. I frankly think this is outrageous. And I'm looking for more facts, but I can't believe that they can't find the kind of savings they need out of that department, short of letting criminals go free.
All right, in the Bush plan that Senator Sessions exposed, remember they were supposed to, 6 years ago, have a secret vote on immigration reform because the last three had failed, but Sessions said, I'm not following unconstitutional Senate rules, and released it. They were going to have felon illegal aliens not be deported when they serve their term, and to sign a pledge not to commit more felonies. Look it up. Aggravated felonies. You know what an aggravated felony is? Home invasion, rape, carjacking. And remember the railway killer who killed dozens of people and they just kept releasing him? Again, they also mainly feed on the immigrant community. The giant criminal hordes that have fled Mexico and come up here are above the stinking law. And have taken over organized crime in the Southwest and are now intimidating the police and buying them off. We're going to fall just like Mexico. I'm telling you, this is how Rome fell. And I'm not even for this Roman Empire. But let me tell you, falling into the barbarians will, and that's what this is. Third world countries are in a barbarian state. And civilization could easily collapse in this country. It did in Russia for a while. And it's still pretty bad. I mean, this is out of control what the corrupt are doing. They're destroying everything because they have an instinct against the good producers. They have an instinct of hating the regular hardworking person. They hate you. They hate Christians. We're going to play a clip right now. David Knight and David Ortiz went up and did a great report in Dallas on the big National Day of Resistance this Saturday. And there's two reports. Here's David Knight's part of the report. We'll get to David's in the third hour if we have time. It's all up at InfoWarsNews.com or PrisonPlanet.tv. If you're not a subscriber, what are you waiting for, folks? We are the tip of the spear. We need your support now more than ever. And I want to thank all you that have supported us. Let's start getting to his report. Here it is.
Well, the keynote speaker was a lady who had lived under Romanian dictator Nicolae Ceausescu. And like so many people that we've talked to before, she has an important story with warnings to tell us about how it got to that position, what it was like to live there. And like so many of the other people, her warning is that we're headed in that direction with many parallels. Here's what she had to say.
More than 20 years ago, I was exiled from communist Romania to America, the greatest country in the world. I came to America as a political refugee from communist Romania. I had with me two daughters and I was pregnant with my son. I had no money and I did not know one word in English. After mastering English, I was admitted and in 3 years I graduated from SMU Law School with two degrees, Juris Doctor and Master of Laws. After that, I established my own law firm. Meanwhile, I raised three children as a single mom. I am the American dream, but I should be dead, buried somewhere in an unmarked grave in Romania, according to the dictator Nicolae Ceausescu. The only thing that make my journey possible, fighting and winning against communists in Romania, is my decision to trust God to help me fight for freedom. If we lose freedom in America, there is no place to escape to. The socialist system is governed by the big government who owns all the means of production, distribution, and determines the good for its people. The socialist system replaces the free market with government control and eradicates private property, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, religious rights, and self-determination as a nation. In the name of promoting fair share, justice, and equality, the socialism turns most of its people into equally poor people. Equality means bringing the country's standard of living to the lowest level possible. Soon after Ceausescu was elected president, he governed Romania with an iron fist, as a despot and as a tyrant. According to him, we the people of Romania was his subjects, owned by him, and he wanted to make all the decisions for us. He nationalized big area of our economy. He eliminated the free market economy of Romania and replaced it with his dictatorial communist control. As businesses had to abide the government's new requests, rules, regulations, they started to produce low quality products that we, the customers, were forced to buy at the price established by the government. He ruined our economy.
Well, I was curious when she talked in her speech about Ceausescu taking away the free market and other freedoms, because I was under the impression that everything just came down like a hammer when the first communist dictators came in. But like Bert from Poland, who, if you remember an interview we had with him a few weeks ago, things didn't happen all at once, just like things are not happening all at once here in America. Now, Bert had told us that in Poland, it took several decades for the communist system to completely suppress and kill all the free market and private businesses that were there. And of course, once those were gone, things got really bad. But here's how Mrs. Prodan described the Romanian takeover.
Of socialist and communist leaders, but he was the worst one. Mm-hmm. He was the one, the only one who declared himself God. And he was the one who fought against Christians and churches, demolishing churches and putting Christians in jail. About he made the secret police, Securitate, as his personal special forces. And he developed the informants. He was worse than Stalin, worse than Hitler. Mm. He killed many people. I am a miracle that I am alive. Mm. I believe the reason is that God protected me, and because in Romania, being a woman means nothing. And he was shocked, a surprise, that I took him to court and I won cases, and I exposed him for to Voice of America, Free Europe.
Well, there's some interesting parallels between this dictator who thought of himself as God and American leaders who think they should control every aspect of our life. Here's what Virginia had to say about that.
He changed our healthcare system for worse into a national healthcare system. Patient-doctor relationship vanished. Patients and doctors lost their freedom. Hospitals were administrated and medication were rationalized by government to patients. Before socialists came to Romania in power, Romania was a rich country with a free market economy, a good healthcare and good school system. Bucharest, the capital of Romania, was called Little Paris. But with socialism and Ceausescu's strict control system, very soon Romania experienced a drastic shortage of food, fuel, energy, medicine, and all the other necessities.
Well, it wasn't just a complete takeover of healthcare. Ceausescu also went after the guns.
Using altruistic purposes, too many kids killed or hurt by guns. The socialist government immediately established gun control in Romania. It created a police system, Securitate, to control and silence everyone, including the media. The Securitate was the dictator's elite special forces, his loyalist and a very privileged group of people. The dictator's ears and eyes, they were powerful and above the law. The secret police also recruited civilian informants. The youngest informant was 8 years old.
Notice how the monopoly and force went hand in hand with the surveillance state.
I was an attorney in Romania, and I am an attorney in America. Like you, I was born with a hunger for truth and freedom. But I was born in communist Romania, a land of lies and a prison land. Not one with real stone walls, steel bars, and watchtower, but a prison land nevertheless. The stone walls were the cruel and harsh life and treatment from the government. The bars were lies, and the watchtowers were the suspicions, anxiety, secrets, and fears. They were everywhere in Ceausescu's Romania.
Living in that prison planet surveillance state, I asked Ms. Prodan what she thought of the watchtowers. And think about, as she describes it, think about the parallels between our current surveillance state.
He had, like I said, secret police everywhere. I had microphones in my house, in my office. I had secret police in outside of my home 24 hours a day. They had informants, everything. Mm-hmm. He was able to listen. So we all live in a constant state of anxiety and mistrust, where one could be denounced for anti-government statement by anyone, a neighbor, a classmate, even a family member. For many people, the only way to avoid dictator's punishment, usually jail or death, was to remain silent, to blend in.
And when she talked about taking Ceausescu to court, I was curious if they had laws there that protected any individual rights. On what basis did she win? Now, there's been a Second Amendment speech of a fellow who was at Tiananmen Square and in Massachusetts. And he talked about the fact that in China, they had laws that protected most of the individual rights that are enshrined in the Bill of Rights in America, of course, with the exception of the Second Amendment. But of course, they didn't pay any attention to them. And a similar thing happened in Romania, but listen to how she described it.
Not sure if we have everything like in America, but I'll give you an example. We have laws in Romania that will protect churches and Christians, but during the interrogation, the laws that I used them against the government, and you hear me saying that I won all of those cases. And the reason is because I used those cases that nobody else in Romania wanted to use or dared to use. And in the interrogation room by secret police, those secret police told me that those laws were in Romania, in the books, so Romania can have or maintain the most favored national status with United States, not for me to use against them. But I was very determined to use, and I told them they're going to law school. Nobody told me that. And I really believe in those laws, and I'm going to use them. And
So the laws there were just window dressing. Nobody really paid any attention to it, isn't it? Very much like what we have with the TSA and with the Department of Homeland Security and with the NDAA. So many places where we have the laws in place, we have very clear constitutional protections of our rights, and the government just chooses to ignore it. But with all this surveillance, Virginia Prodan was not stopped. Listen to what carried her on.
When you stand up and fight for something, it is surprising, might be surprising for others to hear, but others will follow you. Mm-hmm. Or if they don't follow you, at least they will support you. Mm-hmm. So don't think that you are by yourself, because we are never by ourselves. I can tell you stories of unsung heroes in Romania who helped me to from Romania and also Americans. Like I said in my speech, fear and faith are contagious. You have to make sure that you don't spread fear around you. Fight with your own fear inside of you. Win, because God is with us and he can eliminate that fear and give us faith and courage. Spread courage around you and you will be surprised how many people will be encouraged, and you will contaminate them. And one person can change a town, a city, a state, and then United States.
Well, I love what she said. Faith and fear are both contagious. And so it's kind of up to you, isn't it? Are you going to spread faith or are you going to spread fear? Are you going to encourage those around you, or are you going to be the weak spot that makes everybody else weaker? Well, every day is a day of resistance here at InfoWars, and I hope you will join us in that resistance. I hope you will support our sponsors. And if you're watching on YouTube, I hope that you'll support Prison Planet TV. Buy a subscription there. You can give that out to 10 other people who can be watching it simultaneously. You can actually give it to more people, because it's very unlikely 10 people will be watching it at any given time. You'll also have full access to all the documentaries that Alex Jones has produced. So please consider becoming a Prison Planet subscriber. That's it for tonight. We'll be back tomorrow at 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern with the Nightly News.
All right. And again, my plan with the Nightly News is to take all these great pieces they put together and air them here. And the crew did a great job. The big camera they took up there unexplainably broke or malfunctioned in the middle of the speech. They went with handheld, the little camera, and still got it all done. But unusual quality in the info. Sorry about some of the quality on the video, but the guys, it doesn't matter, got the job done. So great job to David Knight and David Ortiz. Now, expanding on that, that's the key I've always explained to you. And that woman is famous, what she did in Romania, what she did once she got out, exposing it, what she did. And you could see the light of liberty in her eyes. She's stronger. She's more beautiful of soul, of spirit, of everything, because she went through the fire. People get scared of the tyranny. They hear when I talk about the problems and it scares them. My mission is not to scare you. My mission is to say, hey, we're in trouble. Become a leader, stand up, others will stand with you, others will follow. And what she talks about is so key. Anytime I've had little inklings of fear or the system's tried to scare me, immediately I can feel God there with me. And I know I'm doing the right thing. If you don't believe in God, justice, whatever you want to call it, doing the right thing, my programming. And it's like I have faith. I'm going to stand against this. And the doors just open. The enemy is absolutely scared of people that love liberty. That's why they wear the black uniforms and the helicopters and the checkpoints and the secret agents on TV and the torture and the sexy women torturing the people in Zero Dark 30 and how they're the good guys and how they're doing all that because it's an illusion they themselves have bought into. Most of them don't even know they're tyrants. Only the more high-level spy masters and global controllers know that. And, you know, my dad, through the church we went to in Dallas, helped with missions to Germany to get people out of East Germany. I've never really talked about that. And we helped people that got out of Germany and East Germany and things like that that came to the U.S. I'm not going to go into the whole story. But the point is that the government obviously knows that. Is that this is a real fight, ladies and gentlemen. And communism is the eugenicist, globalist science of tyranny. And they call themselves liberal. They're not real liberals. Thomas Jefferson was a liberal. And it's so important to realize these people are not liberals. And the Republicans at the highest levels are their partners in this takeover. But she talks about just trusting God and then all the things she was able to do. And that as soon as she stood up, she had power. And Ceausescu, of course, was killed by the people, finally, when the police and military woke up. And the Ceausescu model is something that we could see happen in this country. The problem is there's not just one dictator. It's a collection, a corrupt system. So we have to assassinate the character of the corrupt system and the imposter system that's overtaken our republic and re-upload the republic. The republic born again hard. Come in, join the team, come in for the big win. All right, hour number two straight ahead, InfoWars.com. All right, Katherine Albrecht has gotten here. She's in the green room. We'll get her in here in the next segment. Dr. Katherine Albrecht, leading voice in exposing the technocracy. Hey, will you guys pull me the articles from this week about the big mainstream news about the army of robots taking over the technocracy? I just want to show viewers and listeners some of that so they don't think I'm, you know, just talking about that, because that's what I've been talking about for 17 years, and the smart dust and the RFID and all the rest of it. And what's great is Katherine battles it full time and just recently beat cancer, praise God. Your prayers undoubtedly help with that. And she's going to be joining us in studio for a little more than an hour. And we'll also be taking your calls for her. And we'll get her view on the whole state of the world itself. But we just played that interview with a well-known survivor of Ceausescu's Romania. I mean, they killed hundreds of thousands of people. And that was just a small country. But the example of his arrogance, his corruption, and the whole apparatus. And then finally, people stood up with people like Virginia Prodan, who's now fighting for our Second Amendment here. She's a lawyer and a U.S. citizen. Just part of the American dream. I can't wait to get her in studio with us. I can't wait to maybe go interview her for the nightly news on camera. Just amazing. And then we've also got David Ortiz's report coming up as well today, and a bunch of other reports. There's just so many that are on the nightly news. And I really, folks, the quality of the nightly news, the great reporters we were able to find out there that love liberty through the reporter contest that we did a year ago, or a little less than a year ago, everything is just so amazing. And I'm blessed and honored to be your host. I'm very thankful that we're having these huge breakthroughs. I haven't really talked about it. I mean, that was a big deal. Michael Savage is not so much reclusive, but he doesn't do a lot of media. And to get him on the air, whether you agree with him or disagree, it'll get a lot of people awake. It'll bring a lot of his listeners into this show and vice versa. To go on the Howard Stern show, and they plan to have me around for 30 minutes and basically probably criticize me, but I won him over with the facts. And then they had a vote. I drove in this morning and heard the Howard Stern show. They said, well, we had the Howard fan club vote, a record landslide for Alex Jones as the most popular thing on yesterday's show. It was like 79%, I think. The point is that I give people like, why would you go on the Howard Stern show? Well, because it's super pop culture and super big in Hollywood and super big in entertainment. And if I can go on there and win those people over, because everything I talked about, they're like, wait, I did hear about that. Well, I did just search that. Well, that's true. Well, that's crazy. And I'm on there saying, don't drink the fluoride. Don't take the Prozac drugs. Don't eat the GMO. I mean, it's a real public service announcement. And the fact that, by the grace of God, I'm able to get on the air with the facts, just because I talk like a regular person, and I don't put on airs, and I'm just a real, warts and all, that I'm able to get through to people by the grace of God. Well, so are you. And just as that lady, the survivor of communist hardcore tyranny, talked about how as soon as she started standing up, she couldn't believe the power she had, Virginia Prodan, and how others ended up joining her. Who are the other Virginia Prodans out there? Who are the other Alex Joneses? Who are the other Ron Pauls? Who are the other Dr. Katherine Albrechts? Who are the other people? Because I can tell you something. 20 years ago, I was going to community college, about to go to UT, and every class was anti-American, anti-liberty, classic tyranny. And I went to an Access TV show 17, almost 18 years ago, and had instant success reaching people, and got a radio show 17 years ago, and the rest is history. And I developed my skills as I went along. Still, I'm a train wreck many days. But the point is that it's real It's resonating. We can turn back the evil if you believe and take action and don't stop. We'll be back with Dr. Katherine Albrecht in studio. Ladies and gentlemen, it is the 27th day of February, 2013, on this Wednesday edition. We are now into the second hour. Wow. Howard Stern yesterday, and they said they had a record landslide vote of their Howard Stern fan club, Howard Stern TV members, and 79%, I was driving in this morning and heard it, said that I was the best part of the show. And again, you're like, well, that's a horrible, vulgar, whatever show. The point is, the media listens, it's very popular, and that's how we wake people up to the New World Order, is by going out there and going on Piers Morgan and going on Howard Stern's show and talking to Robin and getting Michael Savage on here. This is the success of liberty. This is what we can do. Expect to get more affiliates. Expect to win battles. Evil is not invincible. We aired a piece last night of a famous lady in Romania who fought against Ceausescu and then got beat him in court, got kicked out of the country, but helped wake others up. And she and others' activities led to the final overthrow of one of the most brutal dictators in the Soviet era there and their satellites. You are the resistance. You have power. Most people that are part of the corrupt system have never thought about it. They believe the false reasons they've been given for it. But as things get more oppressive, as things get more obvious, and as things unfold that Katherine Albrecht and myself and Ron Paul and G. Edward Griffin and countless others, Bob Chapman, the list goes on and on, as more and more of what we talk about manifests and people see the ugly side of RFID or face scanning, biometrics to buy and sell, or drones or checkpoints or arbitrary courts or the police state, or psychotropic drugs, as all this manifests, people are going to remember the seeds we planted today. I can't tell you how many times I plant wildflowers on my little 9-acre plot of land outside Austin, and they sprout better the next year than the year I planted them then, because wildflowers kind of sprout when they like the weather. And so I planted stuff 2 years ago that just sprout is starting to sprout even better than it did, and I didn't plant this year. We're having kind of an early, hope it isn't a fall spring. It's the same thing. It's like rocks in the pond, as it's been said a billion times. Send out ripples forever. Just keep throwing rocks in the pond. Rocks in the pond. Ignore the enemy propaganda. And understand that we're going to take humanity back. And that if you ask God to help you and just trust in God, as the last piece we aired broke down, that God will take you the rest of the way. And that even if bad things happen to you, which usually don't happen, actually. She was talking about how surprised she was. The lady that fought the Ceausescu, that it was the enemy that was scared. It was the system that freaked out. That's why they tried to intimidate, because they are the ones that are afraid. We don't need to be afraid of the New World Order. We need to be afraid of not resisting them and letting them fully take over. We can control our own destiny with God's help. Now, for this rest of the hour and then 30 minutes into the hour after that, speaking of an example of resistance, Dr. Katherine Albrecht hosts syndicated radio program right here on the GCN Radio Network. The Katherine Albrecht Show is a highly effective privacy campaigner and sought-after public speaker and technology expert and author of numerous best-selling books and films. A popular media commentator and dynamic radio personality, she has spearheaded the worldwide movement against RFID tracking going all over the world and implant technology since 2003. Her unique brand of knowledge, coupled with her passion and truth for freedom, have earned her a devoted listening following. And she also does great news vignettes. KatherineAlbrecht.com, SpyShips.com, WordPress.com, KatherineAlbrecht.com. And she's here in Texas with the report we broke, I don't know, 6 months ago, 5 months ago, whatever it was, that then got into the news with the family, where they told the daughter, you've got to wear an RFID chip. Even when you leave and go on the school bus, you have all the reports where they're watching kids on their laptops at home. Court says that's okay. Big brother. You know, it's okay to have cameras in the toilets. It's okay to make people thumbprint to buy and sell. The banks are now demanding it. What will they do once the cashless society's in? Turn off your thumbprint if you're not a good globalist. They've said that. A no-fly list, a no-gun-buy list. That's why this is so important. Add fees. You know, you got a Bank of America card, $5 every time you use your money. There was a backlash today, but Bank of America said, we're getting with the other banks. We're going to do it all together so you have nowhere to run. And Katherine Albrecht joins us to get into all of this and where we are today and to dovetail it with this article. for TV viewers, you can see it here on the document cam. Activists launch campaign against autonomous weapons killer robots. Must be stopped. Now, I've been saying this for 15, 16 years when I read what MIT had planned. All Air Force will be drones. All combat troops will be robots. And a robot can be a Humvee that is robotically controlled, but also self, you know, self-picking its own targets, autonomous as they call them, with a large semi-auto or full-auto 50 cal missiles. Now, I saw this 14 years ago at urban warfare drills, and I talked to Marines off record, including a colonel. They were like, listen, Jones, this is nothing. You ought to see what we've got. This is 20 years old. And I said, well, what is it? And they said, well, you've seen movies like this, seen movies like that. Then I got in contact with some of them afterwards, and they told me what they'd seen, just like those stealth helicopters you saw crash in the bin Laden raid, the so-called bin Laden raid. Yeah, I mean, that was like 30-year-old stuff. Folks, they got stuff that will blow your mind. And they want to roll it all out because the automated system can just be programmed by the globalists and forget the military saying no, like Ceausescu's people in Romania or Operation Valkyrie when the German military tried to overthrow Hitler. You get rid of that when it's all the robots. And with our tax money, they're building this technocracy. That's really when I woke up Howard Stern yesterday and Robin, was I said, you know, Bill Joy wrote in Wired Magazine, the future doesn't need us. He went to an elite meeting. They said they plan to get rid of the vast majority of the public. And that's in all the technocracy publications. And Howard's like, well, there are too many people. I go, yeah, but they're going to get rid of you too. Did you get a memo not to drink fluoride water? No, Howard. You're being targeted. And see, as soon as people get that, doesn't matter you're worth $300 million, Howard. You're not in the top technocracy. You didn't write eco-science. You don't get to go to Moonbase Moonraker, which is really going to be underground. They're not going off-world for this bioweapon release. You're dead. You're dead, Howard Stern. Robin's dead. I'm dead. We're all dead. You better either wake up to this or it's all over. I've seen their master plan. They've written it down. They're arrogant about it. Now, on the ground, fighting it everywhere. Actually, they're focusing on this, and it's important whether you focus on everything like I do or you focus mainly on this and a bunch of other subjects. She does as tertiary. It's important to pick your cross and carry it, and it will empower you. People think of fighting tyranny as horrible. It's the animating contest, as Thomas Jefferson said. Okay, that's my introduction. You're with us for the next hour and 20 minutes or so. Dr. Katherine Albrecht, Harvard degree in your research of this tyranny. First off, before we get into specifics, what is the state of the globe, the state of the battle against the tyrants right now?
Well, I got to tell you, this whole move towards getting people accepting what's happening in the last 10 years has just been mind-blowing. It's to the point now where stuff that I used to be able to talk about 10 years ago that was, I could say, hey, they're going to start tracking you through your shoes, and people would go, that's terrible, let's fight it. Nowadays, I say they're going to track you through your shoes, and they say, yeah, they already tracked me through my cell phone. They're tagging kids now, as you know, at Walt Disneyland, Walt Disney World, with the RFID
total conditioning
on their right hand. So now you've got kids going, you know, the happiest place in the world, the best event of my life. I went to Disneyland. I got tagged with an RFID tag on my right wrist. I'm going to associate that now with fun. So I think what's happening from my perspective in the battle is that it's getting harder to fight because it's getting harder for people to actually recognize that there's a fight that needs to occur. So as these technologies move forward, even there in San Antonio at the schools, a lot of the parents say, yeah, I guess, track my kid. What's the big deal?
It's a normalcy bias.
It is.
And it's a Stockholm syndrome.
And it's new. It's new. This was not the case 10 years ago. When I first started fighting RFID, all I had to say was they're going to track you. And people went, we got to stop it. Now I say they're going to track you. And they're like, yeah, and your point. You know.
No, so it's like, hey, the NSA is listening to you illegally. Yeah. Hey, they're torturing people, including their kids. Well, you got to torture kids. I mean, that's Christian.
It is. It's like the normalization of torture, the normalization of the kinds of foods we eat, the normalization of the expectation we're all going to be sick and chronically ill, that's just part of life.
By the way, congratulations beating breast cancer.
Thank you.
With God's help.
Thank you. Absolutely. That was quite
a How's that going?
That's actually going really well, and I'm going to be starting a new clinical trial at Cornell in New York with a woman who I actually believe may have cured breast cancer.
Well, you know, they've come up with a lot of cures or treatments that are close to cures, but they get shelved.
Right.
The establishment.
This one's interesting because it's being run through Cornell, which is an actual academic university. They're certainly in the inner circle, if you want to call it that. But because the drug itself, it's called tetrathiomolybdate. It's just an ammonium salt of molybdenum, you know, from the periodic table. It doesn't have any. It doesn't have a patent on it. There's no pharmaceutical company making anything off of it. It's cheap enough you could salt the roads with it, and it seems to prevent recurrence of breast cancer.
Wow.
And other cancers as well. And she's not getting the big pharmaceutical, you know, funding to do all the clinical trials, but they're doing the trials anyway, funded by just donations. So it is kind of fun to watch from within the inside to see an alternative
to cure. See the life force still caring.
Absolutely. And a cure that's not going to make anybody any money. It's not going to make anybody super rich because there's no patent on it.
But there's the real wealth of your women in your life not dying.
Oh, my goodness. No kidding.
Expanding on that, why do you think from your research breast cancer is skyrocketing?
I think it's the estrogens. I think it's the fact that virtually everything we eat is in plastic.
The printer ink, bisphenol A.
The printer ink, now it's going to be in our dollar bills. They're going to have the plastic carbonates everywhere. I think we're just drowning in estrogenic substances.
That's right. They picked a bisphenol A to print the plastic in the new dollar bills when there's no need. It's just like, here, kill yourself.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, as you point out with the water, the things that they're adding to the water, now they're finding that even the BPA-free plastics, as I believe you've pointed out recently, those BPA-free plastics themselves now are being shown to be highly estrogenic.
So it makes men lethargic, fat, and unhealthy, and makes women hyperfeminized, but accelerates the aging of the tissues.
Well, and not just hyperfeminized, it causes cancer.
Yeah.
It triggers breast cancer.
But, I mean, Katherine, the government loves us. You know, the good news, Michael Savage was on, and he said they're putting stuff in the water and the food to do this to men and women. I mean, he's saying it. The point is, we're reaching the point, though, where people admit it's going on. Next, they'll be like, so the government's killing me. That's loving. We'll be right back with Dr. Katherine Albrecht. Dr. Katherine Albrecht's our guest. We are being inserted into the matrix. The children, Katherine was just telling me during the break, you know, they have the new children training bodies with the little insertion area for the iPad or iPod. People are just totally not. You go out to restaurants now, myself included, no one's even talking or communicating. They're all clicking, clicking, clicking. That's why I've decided the next few weeks I'm going to take off a full week. We're going to have guest hosts, you name it. No computers. I'm taking my wife and kids to a cabin or something. No computers, no cell phones, no nothing. We've got to get out of the matrix. I mean, I know all this, and I can't stay out of it. I want to get into the specifics of the battle and what's happening. But, I mean, what is first and foremost on your radar, Katherine, right now in this fight to expose that not technology's not bad, but the way it's being deployed by the technocrats is with Trojan horses for control? And what, from your research, do you think they're trying to build? Do you concur with my technocracy analysis?
I do. And I, of course, add the spiritual component, that I believe that what we're building is the body of the beast. Satan, from the very beginning, is one of the powers of God, the power to be omniscient, to know everything about everyone, to be omnipotent, to have the power to create and destroy life, to create and destroy worlds. These are all things that, you know, as you look closer at the battle, you begin to recognize that it is a spiritual battle. And I believe that what we're creating with all of the surveillance, all of the cameras are, you know, the eyes of the beast, all of the microphones on the buses and the microphones that they want to put into our homes, they are the ears of the beast. And ultimately, you know, we've created this web. And you think about the phrase web, what is a web?
Where
there's
a trap.
There's a spider.
Wow.
We call it the net. What is a net? It's a trap. So somewhere there is going to be a spider who's going to come and occupy this web that we've created, and it will have reached its tentacles into every aspect of our lives at that point. So, you know, it's almost like sensing like you've got the Calistoga wagons and everybody's just out there camping and having a great time, but you don't realize they're being surrounded by the enemies all around. And there comes a moment when they're just going to leap out and say, we're going to pull the noose now. So
they already are. They're already saying, no judge, no jury, can't own a gun, veteran. You're in a technocracy now. Face scan to buy and sell. It's all going in right now. The spider is already sitting there. It's a eugenics-based worldwide extermination grid, and I've studied the elite. They happen to be Luciferians. You're right. It's a giant, murderous, blood-drinking spider that worships Lucifer.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess it's called the beast, and its eyes, its compound eyes are just everywhere, and it's growing more of them. And now it's launching in the sea, the air. It's smart dust.
You know, the companies themselves talk about this, and if people say, oh, Katherine, she's just this Christian, and, you know, you don't have to listen to that. Much of this comes from the other side.
Though they say it will achieve consciousness, and then we, the elect, will merge with it.
Yes, absolutely. They are the ones giving it this religious spin.
They're the high priests that plan on climbing into it. As if it's going to let them climb into it.
Exactly. And you've got now Ray Kurzweil, who is the head of engineering now for Google. He's the guy who looks forward to the singularity when we actually merge with these machines.
And he says, we're like bugs.
He says, we're like bugs.
Yeah, and if you don't merge with the cybernetic system, well, it's like stepping on a bug.
My goodness. All right. Well, and what they're aiming for, and again, taking it back to this idea that Satan wants the powers of God, it's a form of immortality, which I believe is hell. It's this idea that you will be able to live forever. Upload your soul. Take your consciousness out of this meat package that you call a body.
Upload it into the beast.
And upload it into the computer network.
Into Satan's mind.
Looping, so you can live forever. And, you know, you look at the people who fall down the rat hole, for example, of World of Warcraft. You know, who are so immersed in that world that their real world, their bodies go to hell, they're not healthy, they lose their relationships, they lose their jobs, because they're immersed in something that's just in their heads.
Who was that lady you had on, the researcher, talking about what the video games are doing to people?
I've had a number of
researchers. Maybe we should have you talk about that.
Fascinating stuff that's happening with the video games. Because
these men don't want to be with their wives. The women don't. They just, you hear people die playing video games for like 3 days straight.
They do, especially over in China. They've now, you'll love this one, Alex, because talk about tyranny. The government in China now is supervising people's use of the internet because they have all these online interactive games. And if you play more than 4 hours in China, they actually begin removing the characteristics of your character. So your character starts getting weaker and slower, and they take away gold, and his weapons don't fire anymore. So the Chinese government is actually observing people's...
Because they want to keep their biological androids functioning well, but as they build the computers, you heard at Foxconn when the humans were all committing suicide last year, they said, we're going to go to robots. They tried robots. They're still not ready. So believe me, once they're ready to kill them, they'll turn on the video games that are so addicting, people are going to sit there till they die. They already have the flicker algorithm. And then everyone will just die, and then the robots replace us.
Well, and what's if you tie this in with Ray Kurzweil's vision, it's that we would voluntarily, because the world is going to become so polluted, because our bodies will be so chronically broken, because there will no longer be any butterflies or trees or flowers or plants, because everything's going to be dark and burned out, you're going to, at that point, want to upload yourself into the beautiful forest in the video game.
And that's why they're trying to wreck the world on purpose while claiming they're environmentalist, and then having the seed arcs in vaults, because they plan on destroying it, but then Lucifer will remake it beautiful. He's just destroying it to rebuild it. Oh, Lucifer. We'll be right back. That's right. When you go along with evil and corruption and don't at least recognize it, you're turning away. It's a sin. And you're allowing everything to rot around you. A nightmare world is being built. And at the middle of it is a wicked, anti-human, technocratic spire. The elites call themselves this. Not just Ray Kurzweil. Yeah, the head of technology at Google. All of them. We have their quotes in Endgame, Blueprint for Global Enslavement. And I love how the New York Times a few years ago talked about Endgame. And it was back when they were saying there was no Bilderberg and Obama and Hillary didn't meet at Chantilly, even though it was all on record later. And they said that Jones believes the elite are going to merge with machines and fly around the solar system. I was quoting Ray Kurzweil. I was and it's said in the film where they said it. It's on record. And technocrats saying we may just blow the earth up for the power, you know, just because we want to exercise the power. All this crazy stuff. And Kurzweil goes and has events with all the top Hollywood, William Shatner, who's a nice guy, but he wants to live forever. He says it. And they offer him, you're going to live forever. You're going to live forever. This is how you do it. And then we're just accepting their plan of how we're going to, quote, evolve. And then I look at everything else they do. It actually is devolving us. Now, Katherine, we've had some nice banter for a few segments, some great back and forth, but I want to get back into, at the core of your research, what they're building, who they are, the spiritual side, because they say it's spiritual. Ray Kurzweil said he doesn't believe in God yet. They will become God. That's a quote.
I do, yeah.
Yeah, merging with the machine. So you've got the floor. I'm gonna sit back.
Yeah, when you think about just biblically, and a lot of what you're saying is about come out. You know, in Revelation, we're actually told, and also in Daniel, the two prophetic books in the Bible, come out of Babylon, that there's going to come a time when it's going to become so corrupt that if you stay in, you will either become a part of the problem or you will become completely corrupted and destroyed. So, you know, come out of her, my people, lest you be partakers of her sins and receivers of her plagues. And so we know, you can look around and you can see it happening. And what's interesting now, I was saying it's a more frustrating battle now than it was 10 years ago, because people don't get what it is that we're fighting or why you would even bother fighting against it. But in a way, it's also an easier battle. Because what I've found is that even when I'm sitting on an airplane, if I start talking about these issues with people and talk about how the world's going in the wrong direction, everybody nods and says, yeah, I feel it too. You know, that there's something coming for us. Everybody has this feeling of almost a predator after the prey. And I think we're all beginning
to... The spirit is warning them.
We're feeling this sense, the get out, run, something's coming.
The spirit.
Everyone's feeling it. And in that sense, I think, and of course, ever since my cancer battle, I don't know how many more years I'll even be here. So I've been much more open about sharing what I believe is the real end game, what's really
happening. That boost your discernment facing death?
Absolutely. Oh my gosh, it put me in a completely different place. I was just speaking to a wonderful friend last night who was helping out here as I'm traveling around and saying, for the first time in my life, I actually feel wise. I feel that I've gained some wisdom from that. And that's been just an incredible, incredible positive journey. I never thought I'd say thank you that I had cancer, but I think that I am actually grateful for what I
Well, accepting death is a real booster in discernment, because then you don't have all the petty things blocking your spiritual vision anymore.
Well, and I think also the stuff I used to think mattered, you know, being respected or testifying before the Federal Trade Commission or having the governor appoint me as the expert member of the study commission on RFID, all of those accolades that the world gives you, all of that recognition that I used to really crave and think was so important. And I have to say at this point, you know, because I kept my mouth shut, I didn't really say what I thought was actually happening. I kept my Christian views to myself. I kept my spiritual views under wraps, because you can't go saying that and then expect that the Federal Trade Commissioner is going to take you seriously. But since having cancer, I have really come to the point where I say what I know and I mean what I say. And I don't really care if people agree or disagree at this point. So it's a new place, and it's a good place. And
you're free.
I'd like for us to become that way a little bit more.
You're free. So get into the nature of it. Get into the technocracy, and then we'll get into specifics how it's working. But I mean, get into the big picture, because
when you look at what IBM talks about, and I fly a lot, so I've gone through a lot of airports, and they've got this big smarter planet, you know, up on all the airports up high. They've got all these billboards. It must cost them millions to put all this up about the smarter planet. And the smarter planet's built on RFID. It's built on all of the sensor network. And they talk about the planetary skin, that the actual planet will develop a skin and be able to sense everything that occurs on it. The Internet of Things, which is the RFID network that I've been fighting all these years, the Internet of Things is the idea that every physical object would be reporting home to the global brain, that you would have this consciousness that would be aware of everything, every tree and every forest, every frog in every pond, every move that you make, every piece of paper you pick up, all of it would be monitored and observed by this centralized brain. And the way they're going to do it is through the RFID system. So somehow they're going to put, and they've been talking about this since 2003, put tiny sensors on every physical object, build it right into every physical object on the globe, so that as the thing begins to, as the consciousness sort of comes in and occupies the infrastructure that's been built for it, that consciousness will use those as sort of nerve endings to know everything. And the scariest thing that I think I've heard all year is the spray-on nanotechnology antennas. So there is a company, they're called, I want to say Camtech, C-H-A-M or C-H-A-M.
That you'll run drones with.
Yeah, so this is actually a different one. This is a surveillance technology or an antenna technology. So let's say, for example, Alex, right now that everything in this room had an RFID tag, or your shirt, your underwear, my top, my shoes, whatever, had an RFID tag, and we went out into the woods. We couldn't be tracked.
There it is.
Because there's no reader. There you go. That's it. Spray-on antenna, wireless in a can. So what these guys have developed, and if you scroll down, you'll see a picture of a tree. All right, see that tree there? It'd be great if you could zoom in and see that it just looks like a regular tree. So there are military antennas that cost a fortune, and they lug them out into Afghanistan so that they can transmit to airplanes or to base stations. What they can do now is take this spray-on antenna, spray it on the tree, and the tree itself becomes the antenna that broadcasts and transmits. You could do this to every tree in the forest, and now you and I are walking through the woods, and the trees are actually monitoring us, and they have a range these trees can send to a passing airplane, and eventually they will be able to transmit to satellites. So what this has done is it's taken the RFID thing that I've been working on all these years, and the piece I've been working on is they want to put the chips on everything, but the real issue is, where are the readers? And once you can do this, you can actually, you could spray the wall. You could paint the walls with this. You could cover every surface on planet Earth.
Smart dust.
And track everything all the time. Well, the dust is the trackable part.
These are the antennas.
These are the receivers.
Keep going.
So anything you can paint with this technology, anything you can paint with this would be capable of picking up all of your signals and emissions.
Did you know Clifford Carnicom, just interrupt, I have to, I can't help it. Clifford Carnicom told me like 13 years ago on air, and of course he worked, I think it was the Forest Service, and he wouldn't say everything off air, and then he wouldn't go back on shows anymore. He kind of disappeared, I guess because of threats is what I heard. He said they're spraying the aluminum dioxide to get into the trees, and they're going to drop some type of other reading substance on it later, but that's all I was told. And he had, like, Department of Energy sources. And I heard that, and I thought, that's a little out there. And then it just clicked when you were saying that. Go ahead.
So, yeah, it would be possible. You could fly over a forest of trees with this dust and turn your trees into antennas that
Keep
would
going.
Actually be broadcasting up to space. So, and the problem with this is it's invisible. You would never know that this paint was even underneath the wall paint of a room that you were in. And then that room could become an actual sort of RFID chamber picking up all these signals. So when we're talking about this web, and something shocked me the other day, it was the realization that we've only had iPhones since 2006 or 2007. I want to say it was 2007 that was introduced. Can you believe that it's only been 6 years that this technology came out?
And they're ubiquitous. It's like part of your body.
Everyone is staring into the device and clicking and thumbing. And if you don't have one, you're behind the times. This is a six-year-old technology, Alex. And so now you say, well, if we're all carrying around now our unique sort of global brain connectors, because we're checking into this thing that's linking us to the global brain, and now all they have to do is build the remainder of the infrastructure, and it's done.
And then launch the drones to kill us.
No. There's many ways they can kill us. Drones are just one.
And that's why Bill Joy, I go back to that 1,000 times, wrote Why the Future Doesn't Need Us back in 2000 in April. And he said, I went to an elite conference with other billionaires. And we said, do we kill everybody or just let people play video games and have a good time? And the answer was, that's bad for the earth. We're going to kill everybody. And then their answer is, we tell you we're going to kill you and you don't care. Well, you know what? I care and you care.
Yeah. And one of the ways that they're killing people, and I've observed this. If you go into even just a standard supermarket and you look at the extra large tub of peanut butter versus the little small thing of peanut butter, the extra large tub of peanut butter, which is meant for the big prodigious families, contains horrible ingredients that aren't in the small container. I've been noticing this lately, that the bulk container.
No, the technocracy admits they've done that for themselves as escape doors.
Absolutely.
But as they shut it down, the eugenicists are now discovering, first it was 80% they were going to kill. Then it was 90% in their literature. Now they're going, actually, we're going to kill 99%. And so the people that are part of it are begging, what do I do to be part of that? Wow. And this is a whole cult where they get off. I'll see them out in public. I go, you're a professor, aren't you? You're a eugenicist. And I'm not talking to you, Jones. This happened 2 weeks ago at a coffee shop. Because I could tell the guy was looking at me going, oh, yeah. And I went, you feel powerful because you're in on this. He was like, get away from me. But I mean, the point is, they're out there like a cult. It's like body snatchers.
Yeah, and even Nancy Pelosi, what was the first thing she did when she got elected to Congress? She redid the congressional dining hall to be all organic food and to get rid of all of the high fructose.
Monsanto, the communist Chinese. All the elites are obsessed. But listen, you're asking me questions. Keep rolling with all these points.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely the elite, if you want to call them that. I call them the pond scum. They're the people who think they're the cream that has risen to the top of the milk, but they're really...
They're the fools that think they won't reap what they sow. They're the fools think that they can do evil and get away with it.
Well, and they view themselves, and I know this because, you know, I went to Harvard, and I go to a lot of these meetings and a lot of these government meetings and such, and they really do view themselves as being smarter than everybody else and really being in a position to kind of direct everyone else's lives. So, you know, the pond scum, the algae that chokes out the oxygen for all the rest of us, this really is their view. And they have built escape hatches. They don't send their kids to government schools. They send their kids to elite prep schools.
With armed guards.
With armed guards. And they don't eat the food that they expect the rest of us to eat. One of my favorite stories was when John Kerry was doing a promotional, smile and greet at Wendy's restaurant. And there he was, and he's shaking hands with the person in the Wendy's apron, whatever. And they put the food in front of him, and he wouldn't touch it. Wouldn't touch it. Wouldn't put a bite in his mouth. And then afterwards, this got written up because they said, oh, he's an elitist. Because afterwards, he went out and got into his little mobile van, and the local country club brought him a 4-course meal. But the fact that he wouldn't even put it to his lips, you would think at least for a photo opportunity.
He did one.
The journalists were watching you, the cameras were on you, he'd at least take a bite. But he didn't even touch it. And who's he married to? Teresa Heinz came.
Heinz.
Of Heinz. And what does Heinz do? They're part of the whole system that provides the food.
And they're all eugenicists. You can take any of these people and research what they give money to because their charity stuff is public. It's all the eugenics groups. Whenever the Secretary of Treasury got like $200 million himself of bailout money and got the waiver from himself to do it, they went and looked and he gave like half the money to eugenics organizations. I mean, they are dedicated to this.
That's wild.
Did you hear about Zuckerberg giving money to the Life Extension Group?
Yes.
Yeah, no, this is their deal.
Those are the folks who want to live forever because that's the animating spirit behind all of this. There's an animating spirit that was put in motion way back in the Garden of Eden. You know, what was the promise that the serpent made to Eve?
I'll make you God.
You will have the power. You will have the knowledge of good and evil. And, of course, God said, well, if you do that, you'll surely die. And he meant if you bite into the apple and embrace the technology, the knowledge that's going to come from that, your whole species is going to die. He didn't mean Adam and Eve right then. He meant your entire community of the future is going to
die. If you become, because Satan can't create, he has to use God's creations made in the image of the creator. The devil isn't creative. He is literally using us to build his master temple.
Indeed. And that's really how I view it. And I've been asked before, the people who are developing these technologies, do they sit around and worship black candles and have pentagrams? And of course, you've exposed that some of them do. But in my experience, many of them are just day-to-day trying to pay their bills, trying to pay their mortgage.
Yeah, but at the very top, they don't worship the devil. They worship the beautiful white angel. And they believe they're Lucifer, but they see it as the angel of light.
Yeah.
And that, no, Lucifer's really God, and this is a bad creation. And we've got to do this to save the earth. And they'll work 20 hours a day to bring Lucifer in.
And then you look at the fruit of it, though, because the Bible tells
us it's horrible.
To judge a tree by its fruit. And so you can say, what is the fruit? And I challenge anyone out there to name a technology that's really gotten a hold that doesn't have a downside. You know, we open our book Spy Chips talking about, we have a quote from C.P. Snow, a New York Times journalist, and he says, technology is a queer thing. It gives you great gifts with one hand, and it stabs you in the back with the other. And it really does feel that way. You look at everything from pesticides. You know, our grandparents thought in the 50s that better living through chemistry, that was going to save us. It was going to eradicate the mosquitoes with DDT. And look at the outcome of that. We don't have birds. We don't have butterflies. We don't have diversity.
We're not living as long as we used to.
Wait, we have Monsanto. Exactly. So you tie all that in. What did the pesticides lead to? Well, they led to the rise of Monsanto.
And this is all just the launch pad. The reason people are freaking out is the new age, and not the one that people talk about, the new technological hyper dark age, where it's a technocracy dark age against the spirit. It's here. And everything we've seen built up, we're now at the edge of the cliff. Now the real plunge is about to happen. And that's why everybody's like, because deep down the spirit's going, mayday.
People feel it. They absolutely feel it. And that's why whenever somebody says, well, why are you fighting this? You know, if it's inevitable, if you've got your biblical beliefs, why would you fight against it? It's going to happen. And my response to that is we're not going to stop it. I mean, as much as I hate to say that, I feel like the years that I've battled, the last 13 years, that I've fought against RFID and all these privacy invading technologies, it's like there's been a mudslide coming down the hill, and I stood and I held my ground with my piece of plywood, and I held firm ground, but it just went around me. It's coming anyway. So we can hold our little pieces, and I encourage everybody to do that, because the longer we can hold a space for our family, for our children, for the future, for posterity, the better, and the more people we can inform. But ultimately, this stuff is going to be a mudslide rolling down the hill. And the real answer to that, then, is the same answer back in the Garden of Eden. I view us as being like the crew of the Titanic. We struck an iceberg way back when Eve bit into that apple. We've been taking on water ever since. The ship is going down, and we're not going to stop it. But when you look at the actual Titanic, the reason so many people drowned, do you know that those lifeboats were half empty?
They hadn't trained, they didn't know, and they told the poor, stay down there while the elite went to the escape hatch.
They did.
That's why the patriots need to move to the lifeboats right now.
Absolutely.
Long before everybody else does. The elites have already moved to the country and moved to the middle of nowhere with armed guards. Whoever can, even you've got to get ready, folks.
And I think a big part of that, too, is the job that you and I do, which is a job of sounding the alarm, because the crew on the Titanic didn't do a very good job, did they? Because people kept dancing. They didn't want to jump out into the dark cold in a boat.
They were in denial.
Believe it.
It was a great example of learned helplessness or denial about a situation you're in.
But this ship couldn't possibly sink. Look, the lights are on. The music is playing. And I think a lot of people still have that attitude today. Look, I still have my video games.
And I'm like, cancer's up 3,000%. They're like, never mind. And we'll be right back. Incredible. Stay with us. I'm the voice saying I'm not going along with the tyranny. I'm the voice. You're the voice saying no to the technocrats and that we see through their agenda. They don't want our guns to help the kids. They want our guns to enslave us. They don't want us eating GMO so we live longer. In all the studies, it kills the rats. We know what it's doing to us. We know what their technocratic plan is. Total world government, where they kill us and they live forever. They're a bunch of delusional crazies that have seized the human brain trust and used it to take over the world. And I want to say something. We're going to talk about this in the next hour. She'll be with us the whole next hour. And we'll take calls the last 30 minutes because this is a powerful interview with Dr. Katherine Albrecht here in studio with us, syndicated host, best-selling author, researcher, recently has cancer in remission. I need to pray for her. She's going to get scanned again soon to see if there's any metastasization. So again, pray for her. Pray for everybody. Pray for liberty. Pray for me. I certainly need it as well. All the stuff going on around here, we wouldn't be around if it wasn't for the prayer. We don't just believe in prayer. We rely on it. But I just wanted to point out here before we go back to her that she's got some big news in the next hour about organizing against the chipping of the kids. And they're even going for implanted chips in the dogs and then the kids forcibly. She's been to Washington, been fighting for that. That even if biblically this stuff's going to come in, and what it doesn't make you believe in the Bible, everything it said is coming true thousands of years ago. It's the journey of warning people so that at the critical time they'll recognize it once it's even in. It's just the soul that matters. And then defeating it after that. The beast comes in. But then it only rains for a short time. It's going to be hellish. But how many people does the Bible say is going to end up? Is it two-thirds, a third? How many people in Revelations get killed? It's a large amount. I mean, only nanotech could make the ocean completely die. I mean, folks, again, you better hope the Bible's wrong, ladies and gentlemen. And I don't mean what the fake preachers are preaching. Briefly here, paying some bills. We have the very best products, Pro Pure at the lowest price at InfoWarsShop.com or InfoWarsStore.com. You can get 11 memberships, your one membership and 10 more at PrisonPlanet.tv and see the video of the Daily Show, the radio show, the nightly news show, 7 o'clock Central, all my films. I mean, 11 memberships for $5.95 a month, or get the yearly membership and get 5-plus months free off the regular price. The T-shirts, all of it. Support us. Buy the products, InfoWarsStore.com. Or 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And also spread the word about the broadcast in your local AM and FM stations, XM 166. Spread the word about everything we're doing. That's how. Tell talk show hosts, big national ones, you want to hear me on their show. You want to hear Katherine Albrecht on their show. Because that's how we're going to reach people. Now, we only got a few minutes left here, Katherine. Then we're going to come back with all the big news and specifics of the technocratic takeover and why even the elites are talking about a robot takeover, which they command, of course, taking human will out of it, they believe, and why it's so important to keep the guns for defense against that, because there's going to be major resistance to this planetary-wide. And the Bible says, if we get biblical, that there'll also be remnant areas and protected areas. And right. I believe Texas is going to be one of those areas. I mean, Pastor David J. Smith said praying to God like 30 years ago, he was told, move to Texas, this is all going to happen. And it was, I mean, the point is that you've got to know that there's not all doom. We need to stand against this regardless. Maybe get a reprieve like Nineveh got for 100 years. We don't know. But Katherine, we've got about a minute and a half left in this hour. Plug your speaking at Brave New Books tonight and some of the other stuff that's happening.
Absolutely. Harlan Dietrich has invited me out at Brave New Books at 7 p.m. I'm going to be talking about giving people an update on the student shipping that's going on in San Antonio. We have now stepped into the fray. I'm rolling up my sleeves and taking that issue on. So I encourage people to come out and join us at 7 p.m. Start Page is helping to sponsor that event. Help to get me out here.
Startpage.com.
Startpage.com, the world's most private search engine. Good stuff.
And it's little stuff like using Startpage, which I'm starting to do more and more. People don't even know what it is. So I say it's big. It's one of the biggest. But I say, hey, Google, the clean Google is startpage.com.
Well, instead of saying Google it, we're trying to say start page it. Just erase that from people's vocabulary. That's the goal. Because there are things that we can do. We're not hopeless. We're not helpless. There are things that we can do, and some of them are really easy.
And I met the developers and creators of it. Amazing people.
They were right here in the studio.
Back in 60 seconds. Well, she's here in studio with us, and we're talking about the biggest issue out there. What is the technocratic architecture of the technocracy that the globalists admit they're building? And every book they've written, every publication, every transcript, it's just nightmare. how there will be world government by 2020. There will not even be families, men or women anymore. You will merge or you will not be part of the collective. We might let you live in ghettos. And then you see Planned-opolis videos that show kids in Britain where it shows that future. I mean, it is a prison planet. That's why I call it prisonplanet.com. Doc, we're going to go to break. This is a short kind of no man's land segment, but what are you going to be covering throughout the rest of the hour before we take calls?
Well, I want to talk about the fight that we've mounted in San Antonio against the radio tracking beacons around children's necks. That's got to be one of the worst things that I've seen.
So we'll cover that next, and also what's coming up in D.C.
Talking about what's going on in D.C., the coalition that's been put together to fight back against that, and I've also got some news from Start Page, and we've got good stuff going on.
And I want to get also into just some of the other technologies coming in.
There are a lot of them. And I think what I'm seeing now is the convergence of not just the technology, but the mindset. Because I'm sure you have listeners right now listening to this program who, if I told them, hey, listen, your cell phone is tracking you, they would say, yeah, well, you know, what can we do? It is what it is. You know, so even people who love liberty, even people who know what's coming, even people who want to fight it, are starting to feel that there's really nothing we can do about it. That it's kind
they
of
they think
like
there's a power into just saying so what.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's perfectly put. There's almost a sense of empowerment of I'm not going to let it scare me. I'm just going to accept it. And I think that
I'm not going to let it scare me that the GMO kills mammals that eat it. Here, 2-year-old, my son, had the food.
Yeah, it's playing right into the hands.
Your 10-year-old has cancer. Well, that's it. Yeah. And then all the crying and I'll go on a jog to get the cure. No, they killed your son. They killed your daughter. And then now you're going to go jog to collect money for them.
Yeah, so it does play directly into that. And you were asking about what is it that's causing all the breast cancer. I think it's also the same thing that's causing all the gender confusion. Because when you have all these estrogenics in the food, in the pesticides, in the genetically modified stuff, then you wind up with gender confusion. You wind up with it like this guy in Japan who removed his own genitalia and served it at a banquet because he didn't want to identify with being male or female. He just wanted to chop it off.
Well, look at Japan has like 1.2 kids for every adult, for every two men and women. And now the new chic thing is adult diapers because it's so trendy to poop your pants. I'm sorry to say that in front of a lady, but
Japan is a very odd place.
Did you see that record?
Japan is a very
adult diapers place, now yeah. Outstrip child.
Yeah, I don't know.
And then I saw it and thought, oh, that's an old population. And no, it says in the Bloomberg article that it's like really trendy.
Yeah, and Japan has a lot of perversity behind the scenes. I actually studied Japanese for 2 years in school. I spent some time over in Japan in Tokyo, and I had a horrific experience when I was in Japan. I was in a bathroom stall at a train station, and someone, my boyfriend was outside, and saw a drunken guy wander into the bathroom. This guy jumped up over the stall with a camera and took a photo of me and then ran out, and that... You can buy publications available on the street corners of magazines full of that kind of sick thing. And you think now, this was years ago, you think now, what could they do with today's technology in Japan? What could they do with today's technology anywhere? They could have those cameras hidden in anything.
Well, the court ruled that public schools can watch your kids undress with laptops at home.
Well, and
I mean, that's totally illegal.
And Big Brother Watch just finished telling us that over in England now, they're finding that the schools are installing video cameras in the changing rooms and in the bathroom stalls.
And they tell the kids also thumbprint like 007 in biometrics. Don't tell mommy and daddy. You're now 007.
Oh, yes.
It's all about breaking that, you know, the family. Your family's not your family. The state is.
And that's what Hitler did, of course. He said, I don't care about you guys. I want your kids. It's your kids I want. It's their kids I want.
I remember 12 years ago when I caught bribes, or 13 years ago at the Capitol, the head of the group said, we don't care. We'll get your guns. We've got your kids. To the newspaper, we've got your kids. I mean, these are evil degenerates. We've got your kids. We'll be right back.
Homeschool.
Escape from the technocracy. Escape from the new world order. For me, when I realized there's a scientific group of authoritarians wanting to take over the planet, I learned this 20 years ago, I was like, I want to fight these people. And look what I've been able to do, and I'm just an average person. But it's a normal response for a man or a woman learning that a horrible world's being created to want to change that. And I think it's the difference between being a spectator and being someone active in the world. And Katherine, we were talking during the break about people that think it's winning to just give in. And that is not the case. Now, Now, there's a bunch of stuff we're going to get into. The coalition you're forming to fight the RFIDing of the kids in school with the tracker systems. We're going to take phone calls. We're going to get into a host of other really important issues. But you said you wanted to talk about Piers Morgan.
I did, actually. And, you know, a lot of people have said, well, what in the world happened when Alex Jones went on Piers Morgan? And I said, probably one of the most powerful things that's ever occurred. And let me tell you why. Because, Alex, the people that were fighting, they don't respond to us showing a belly and rolling over and saying, oh, yes, I'm defenseless. They respond to being afraid. So, you know, it's the same idea. When the people fear their government, we have, when people fear their government, you have tyranny. When the government fears the people, you have liberty. When I saw you on Piers Morgan, you know what I thought of? I thought of Afghanistan. And let me tell you why. When the U.S., I protested this war. When the U.S. decided to go into Afghanistan, I'm no military strategist. I knew that was going to be idiotic. Why? Because everybody who has ever tangled with Afghanistan has absolutely gotten their butt kicked. Everybody. So the Soviets went in with all of their Cold War technology, couldn't touch Afghanistan. Everybody who's gone in there has gotten absolutely reamed. And we're getting reamed over there, too. Those people are tough. They're bad, as in badass.
Well, they just won't give up.
Yes. And so when you know that if you tangle with them, you're going to get in trouble and it's not going to come out well for you. And that was exactly the sense that I had with you on Piers Morgan, was that the people who want to take away our guns, who want to take away my gun, I own guns. Those people taking a look at you are going to say, you know what? I don't know if it's going to be safe to try to take those guns away. So I want to thank you. And, I'm no big fan of the people of Afghanistan. I mean, I actually do admire their moxie.
Sure.
I admire their ability to fight back. I admire their tenacity. But I have to say that there are some certain people you don't want to tangle with.
Well, you're nice to say that. I mean, the Lord works in mysterious ways, it's been said. They begged me to go up there. I said, okay, I'll do it in studio. That way they couldn't cut me off and stuff. And I just so happened to get sick that day going and was hacking and coughing and had a stomach ache. And, you know, I didn't want to get into it on air, but, you know, threw up a little bit. And that's why I blew up at the TSA, because when I get sick and I'm made to get up out of a bed, I'm in a bad mood. And then I blew up at him because he was sniveling. I know he wants my guns on record, acting like he doesn't. Oh, we're just being reasonable. Mm. I'm like, look, you want my guns, it's going to cause a civil war. Mm. Because it is going to cause a civil war. And I've had sheriffs and police chiefs and internal West Point documents that are now out say there'll be a civil war. There will be. So don't act like there's not going to be a civil war. And listen, Piers, when the civil war starts, you're an enemy redcoat. So I was there just saying, look, stop playing games here. I know. And I was intending to say it nicer, but because I was sick, And I guess it was a scene, me and they're sweating and all the rest of it. I think it did get the message. And notice they said, oh, it was discrediting for us. No, they want us in a coma. And I'm not just putting perfume on a pig. This resonated, and that's why they said they won't have me back on, because I ran back into him in Houston and his producers. I went down there to cover it when he was down there a few weeks ago. They said, oh, we gave you too much attention. We're not doing it. No, that event got a lot of attention and had people go at first because they're in a coma. They're in a trance. Oh, my gosh, that's so mean-sounding. That's so angry. That guy. But then I said, America, why are you upset by somebody saying, don't take my rights, when Paul Revere didn't just yell? He said, get your guns and kill people. And oh, he's a founding father. I'm just saying, hey, watch it, buddy. Don't you try to take our Second Amendment. How do we get so gelded, so conditioned that was alien? And so at first it was uncomfortable to get woken up from a sleep. But then people went, like a day later, including family, wait, this makes perfect sense. So it was almost a trance-breaking thing. And a lot of media analysts I talked to, and also some people like Billy Corgan and the Smashing Pumpkins, sent me a text right after it, and he said, you just broke the trance. And he's a really smart guy. But I heard that from other media analysts, you name it. They said, no, it was a famous event in American TV history, because it was almost like Howard Beale getting off script. But anyways, I'm ranting.
I agree entirely. And, you know, it kind of gets back to what I was saying about after cancer. I just say what I know. You know, I'm sure a lot of people watched that, and they didn't like you very much. And you know what? They shouldn't. The people who want to take away our guns shouldn't like us. They should be afraid of us. They should be uncomfortable in our presence. They should bow and kneel before us because they're our servants. And I actually, as a woman, I'm in no position to get up there and yell in their faces. That's not my role. That's not who I am or how I am. But I got to tell you, I am very glad that you are standing between me and them.
Well, you're very sweet, but as a woman, you're out there fighting the globalists really hard. My only issue is it is men's main job to stand up to usurpers, and men aren't doing that. It is a usurpation.
Amen.
Our ancestors started a war with the greatest empire the world had ever seen that lasted 6 years and killed hundreds of thousands over this.
Amen. And it is. And it is the role of real men. And that's one of the reasons why you can't even buy a sandwich down the street without there being soybean oil in the mayonnaise. Because what does soy do? We have study after study after study showing that it emasculates men. It reduces testosterone levels. One of the reasons why in the prisons they feed soy to the prison inmates is because it makes them docile. It turns them into domesticated.
I heard the guest you had about the medical problems it's causing.
Immense. Incredible. That was Sally Fallon from Nurturing Traditions. She's actually got a lawsuit against, I believe, the Ohio prison system because they're feeding those prison inmates up to 70 grams of protein, soy protein a day. And it's destroying their health. It's giving them leaky gut syndrome, holes in their stomach. They've got chronic health problems, joint issues, you name it. And it's not only that, but the real issue, the real reason they're feeding everybody soy is because they want to emasculate the men.
Well, the social engineers call us animals, and we're like wild pigs to them that they're feeding poison to. And then we just run up and do it, then we run off. And you know, we know the system's bad, but we still come up and eat their food. And, you know, while we're looking around like a pig, I mean, think about that. We got scientists writing white papers about how we're animals and how they're poisoning us.
Yeah.
I mean, I have John P. Holdren's book right there. I mean, that's war. He should be in prison.
You know, there's a guy named Dwayne Andreas who was featured in the movie The Informant a couple of years back. And Dwayne Andreas is the head of Archer Daniels Midland. You know, you always hear they fund NPR and you hear their names all the time. Dwayne Andreas is known as the Soybean King because he took soy, which was not a human food. In fact, people didn't even feed it to their animals because it was toxic. It was silage. They used it just for the hay. And he turned soy into a human food by flying all over the world. He's known, if you look him up on Wikipedia, Dwayne Andreas is known as the number one political donor in all of history of the 20th century. He has like a life-size bronze statue of Ronald Reagan to get Ronald Reagan on board. He traveled and visited with Castro and visited with the Kremlin and went behind the Iron Curtain all through the 60s, 70s, and 80s and got all of those countries to introduce soybean oil as the key number one oil being consumed.
And that was the dream of Henry Ford, who was a eugenicist.
Well, it was prior to that, and you can look this up, they couldn't give it away. They could not give it away. Soybean oil is used for making paint. It was not food. It's never been food. But what they discovered is that if they could take this soybean oil, which can be cheaply produced, and get it out in mass to the people, obviously it starts having a huge impact on fertility. I blogged about this. They've done studies where boys exposed to soy, the little tubules that do all the stuff, testosterone and all of that, they don't form properly. So that's why we're seeing these hamsters. If you feed them soy, they actually, their testicles shrivel up after three generations and they are infertile. They literally can't procreate.
And they have hair on their tongues.
And they do.
And giant tumors.
Absolutely.
But that's loving.
Well, you know, and the women, they have difficulty bringing their babies to full term. So this is the baby hamsters. I'm sure it's happening to women as well. And so what are we seeing? This huge explosion of gender confusion.
And now they're saying you shouldn't be able to eat beef or poultry. Go to soy. It's humane.
Yes.
And the school lunch programs, you know, Michelle Obama, eat your soy.
Yeah, and it's genetically modified in the first place. But even if you eat organic soy, it's not good for you. It's one of the most highly estrogenic things you can eat. Sally Fallon has some amazing research up on her website, points to studies that show that if you feed a baby an infant soy formula, that baby is receiving as much hormone as if you were giving that baby a birth control pill. That's immense amounts.
Totally fries them. Well, listen, I look at photos, people in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, they look totally different. I was reading where people even eat less calories today than they used to 50 years ago, but it's about cut calories now instead of like, what are the calories?
Exactly.
And it's never, why is everybody getting breast cancer? It's find the cure, because they're doing it to us. I mean, they allow McDonald's to feed us plastic in the chicken McNuggets, silicone.
And now aspartame in the milk, you know, it's
and hard. Not tell us.
And what's even more interesting is, why is there this pathological desire? I know here in Austin, they just had a hearing this morning on the organic milk issue, the raw milk issue. Why are they so pathologically determined to ensure that we don't have alternatives?
Because it's a superfood.
To make sure that we cannot go out onto our own property. It's going to come to the point, I guarantee you, Alex, where you're going to need a permit to put a seed in the ground.
Oh, no, they're already trying it all over the country.
where you're not going to be able to grow your own food, your own garden. You're not going to be used.
Well, Monsanto wants that. They just sued 400 more farmers where their stuff infects you. You have a record of the seeds you bought, not from them. They can go find where, you know, because plants aren't one daddy, one mommy. If it's 1% a Monsanto plant from pollen that blew in, the court rules that they run. And now they're saying, how about everyone just has to get inspected or licensed to grow anything?
Yeah.
I mean, what will we not put up with?
Invasive species. There are now regulations about transporting seeds across state lines because you might transport in some invasive species. They now have satellite programs that, based on the color of the crops, can identify whether it's...
Oh, yeah. No. They're already using the drones and the former NSA spy satellites to watch us. And exactly. It's hell on earth.
You know, I interviewed Noah Hutchins from Southwest Radio Ministries. He's like 90, 95.
I've been on his show.
He's amazing. He's still doing a show all these years. Interview him and ask him about his experience during the Great Depression. He was 16 years old flying an airplane, surveilling over farmers' lands to make sure they weren't planting crops.
I want Noah Hutchins on.
Destroy it.
Southwest Radio Ministries. I've been on there a couple times. Like the one time, the times I came on, I was so tired, I just kind of ranted the whole time. You know, I rant when I'm tired. It's like a crutch. But yeah, Southwest Radio Manager, I want Noah Hutchins. That is a living legend right there. I want him on the show. Katherine, stay there. We're going to come back with more news and phone calls. I want you to tell the Noah Hutchins story, one of the first people to ever surveil with aircraft in the U.S., and now he exposes it. 90 years old, but you also mentioned this, and here's the Wall Street Journal for radio listeners, how the insurer knows you just stocked up on ice cream and beer. And we told you this, under the socialist healthcare written by the insurance companies, fascist profit, but socialist control over you, they will know everything you eat, everything you do off the store loyalty cards, or even off the credit card with a data mining tied to your name. And Katherine, I talked about this, you talked about this more than a decade ago, and now they're just flaunting that what you buy is given to your insurance company. No judge, no jury, no contract you sign. That's why they get so mad when you pay with cash. But we'll get to that. First, get into the Noah Hutchinson story, and then I'll give the number out.
Yeah, so Noah Hutchins, during the Great Depression, he was, I think he was 15 or 16, and everybody needed a job, so he lied about his age. He tells this story, which I think is interesting, because now you never get away with this, but lied about his age and got a job flying aircraft and going out to all of the farmers' lands to ensure that they weren't planting crops. So this was an era, and it still blows my mind to this day, that they were burning hundreds of thousands of bushels of corn and wheat and things that farmers had grown in an effort to try to create a shortage to drive the price up. And one of the things that they would do is they would say, if you agree to let your land lie fallow, not plant anything, we'll pay you X amount per acre to plant nothing. And so some of the farmers said, well, forget that. It's my land. I want to grow crops, at least for my own family. And Noah's job back then, which he now regrets, he can tell you the story, but this is back in, the 1930s, is he would drive out in a pickup truck to these properties. And the farmers would meet him with a shotgun at the gate, said, you can't come on the property. And say, well, I'm with the government. I've got to inspect to see if you're growing food. And they would say, no, you can't come on the property. So then they put him in an airplane. And he would fly, literally, the very first aerial surveillance used by the government in this country was used to see if people were growing food on their own property. You can tell the story. It's amazing.
And that's what they're doing now, this whole police state control grid, the Pentagon, Northcom, is, you know, we have a old family ranch. We don't even really hunt on it much. But, you know, every once in a while, at the first day of deer season, if you happen to be there, you know, the game warden will pull in or whatever. And now it's just like, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15 people will show up and just start demanding, get in that truck, get in that, you know, we don't need warrants. We're God. We're under a federal task force. And but meanwhile, the borders are wide open, the government's shipping in the drugs. But it's all about government, like, bugging their eyes out at you, like, it's our country now, boy.
And the idea now is, how many places can you put the eyeballs? So we've already got the satellite imagery watching you. Now we've got the drones that can fly over. We've got the, you know, little dragonflies with a camera in their nose that can fly around your property. And eventually they want to do these antenna trees and put surveillance devices on literally everything in your property.
To read the smart dust.
Yeah. There's
and then bathe everything in RF.
Yes. And there is, we actually saw when we were researching spy chips, Liz and I came across a plan to put an RFID tag in every single tree on Earth. They actually calculated the number of saplings that come up out of seeds every year across the entire planet and calculated how feasible it would be to track every single...
And then have us pay for it.
Well, of course.
I mean, that's the great part, is you work to put all the extra tech in the iPhone or the robot attached to the side of your house called a smart meter that's breaking into everything, tracking you, and then admitting it's doing it.
Well, and let's talk about payment here, because I want to tie this back to San Antonio, where I was just down yesterday. We met for a couple of hours with the vendor that's producing these radio tracking beacons around kids' necks. And he was boasting, well, we use this down in the Spring Independent School District down in, you know, Houston, and we saved them $1 million.
That's like saying, well, there was slavery before. I mean, there's lots of slaves in Angola. Well, we're going back to slavery.
Well, this idea that they've saved $1 million in missed attendance over the last 4 years, and then he turns around and in almost the same breath, he says, and the city of San Antonio, this district is investing $13 million in surveillance cameras. And I said, hang on a second, so you're tracking kids so you can save $1 million in lost attendance money, and then you're turning around and spending $13 million on surveillance cameras? So where is the money coming from, and what is the money being used for? Do we really need $13 million worth of surveillance cameras in one tiny district in San Antonio? So all that justification, this immense amount of money that gets spent.
By the way, those cameras are Department of Defense paid for, our money again, that scans with a smart computer how much calories you eat off the apple, and it's watching what the kids eat. I mean, this is beyond 1984.
Yeah, and what the vendor was telling us, a company called Wade Garcia that put this program together down there, they were actually telling us that they've gotten inquiries from schools that want to have GPS trackers on the kids and want to be able to track them when they go home at night. Actually want to track them off the campus. He was saying one of these administrators says, I can't sleep at night thinking that when the kids get off the bus, they've got to walk home. We need to have GPS. You've got to make it more affordable.
Well, and they need to then say the kid was out too long so CPS can come take your kid.
Yeah. There's a million things you can do once you track them home.
Here's the toll-free number, folks, 800-259-9231 for questions for Dr. Katherine Albrecht and myself, Alex Jones, 800-259-9231, specifically on the Technotronic takeover. Steven Yiannakis, the retired top general, is working with Mayor Bloomberg on how the military can be used to confiscate our guns. You know, I thought, hey, I haven't hit refresh on Infowars.com in about 45 minutes talking to Dr. Katherine Albrecht here in studio with us in Austin, Texas. I better hit refresh. And during the break, I hit refresh, and during the break, I watched some of the video we're downloading right now. We'll have it after we take some calls. This is kind of a, you know, emergency. They've got counties all over going, we'll just take guns during any storm or problem, just like Katrina. And now retired general tells Biden military can help with gun control agenda. Feinstein again promises to press the case for disarming the American people, and we have the memo from the Justice Department saying ban all the guns and turn them in. And the communist Chinese, I forgot to mention this yesterday when Michael Savage was on, because his premise is that's who uses the muscle. They said the People's Daily twice, wage a war against your gun owners. That's a quote. We're ready to help, and by the way, we own your debt, so step and fetch. So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, punch this up for folks. Retired general tells Biden military can help with gun control agenda. Yep, the big red one can come to your town and kill your mommy and your daddy, because you know the extremists aren't Al-Qaeda now. It's the gun-owning conservative libertarian. Look at Feinstein. I made over $100 million when I went to the Senate off $175,000 a year. Yeah, if you believe that, I got a bridge I'll sell you. So amazing, amazing that that story's been out. I haven't even covered that. That is just incredible. We'll get back to more of that here in just a moment. New York 7-round law bans most firearms. Eyewitness, yes to the Nazis, did confiscate guns. The media is denying that says Hitler was pro-gun, even though it's on record he wasn't. It's just incredible lies. Just like, did you see where Robert Gibbs, Catherine, was told? Now, the drone program is public and admitted, all the world killing people, but you're to say it doesn't exist. And he said, yeah, but that didn't make sense. But it was the Karl Rovian idea of just say there is no RFID. There is no cancer increase. There is no new world order. Well, wait, you just announced it. And I had the Nightline host, the ABC Nightly News host, go, that's a different world government. I mean, it's like they've gotten to the point where it's a learned, what do you call that psychologically?
Yeah, you know, I'm not really sure. But if you give people who don't want to know, if you give them somebody to point to and say, see, they said it's not true, then you let people kind of hide. And I think that's really what it's about. They know, if you're paying attention, you know they're absolutely lying. But then you go and you talk to your mother-in-law or you talk to, you know, your brother-in-law, and they say, you're full of it. Look, this expert just finished saying it's not
true. Yeah, they don't respect you. They respect the expert they don't know.
Yeah, which is I think the purpose of that outright propaganda that you can see through like a transparent, you know, sheet of saran wrap, the reason for it is that there are people who will cling to it no matter how ridiculous it is.
Because they're in denial because they're scared.
Yeah, and they want
so it's like, no, the world is round. They're like, nope, Robert Gibbs said in this document it is flat and that there's Candy Rock Mountains at the end of it.
That's right. So that's why it works. So if you ever wonder, why would they say something so obviously false? Like, do they think we're stupid? And the reality is they it's not that they think we're stupid. It's that they know that there are people who will cling to that and use it to tell you to shut up.
Well, and it's also an acclimator where you just get used to them just pushing bizarre baloney.
Yeah. It is too, right? And you get to the point where we're becoming overwhelmed, I think, with so many different voices.
When I first interviewed you, and then we're going to go to calls, in 2001, when you were first, you know, you were in Harvard at the time or whatever, you were fighting the loyalty cards. Then you got into RFID, and you said they're using it to track and do all this. They'll use it for your health insurance under socialist health care. And now let me punch it up for viewers out there. Voila. How the insurer knows you just stocked up on ice cream and beer, the exact examples I used years ago was ice cream and beer, to now increase your insurance because they say that's bad for you, even though most studies show a couple beers actually relaxes you. I mean, you can argue it gets extreme and gets abused, sure. Or who's to say you can't go run 5 miles and have some ice cream? This is the nanny state, and now Bloomberg says what you'll eat. Michelle Obama says what you'll eat. I mean, these people are incredible.
I got to say, back in 1999, when I founded Caspian and we put up the nocards.org website, which is ancient now and hasn't been updated, but it's historically still there, nocards.org. Back when I put that website together, the concern was that we are registering our purchases. So whenever you scan a supermarket card, you are registering your food. And the reason that we all resist the registration of guns is because we understand first they register, then they regulate, then they restrict, then they confiscate. And the same is true for food. First, they register, which is what these supermarket cards are. Then they will begin to restrict and regulate, and then they will begin to confiscate. So
look at this. It even says that the employers get into the files and get to know what you're eating now.
Yeah.
Because, the fun is everyone gets to be a Stasi spy.
Yeah.
I mean, holy crap. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So the idea here is that you will be told when you get to the supermarket, and there are people talking about this, that when you put that pound of butter in there and you scan your frequent shopper card, which will at some point, I believe, become mandatory, they'll say, no, I'm sorry. You've already had your monthly quota of butter. You can't have that butter. You're going to have to put that back and get.
And by the way, the top environmental groups say, with all this now, we will ration what you eat.
Absolutely.
That's in the Plantopolis videos for kids where you get meat on your birthday.
Absolutely.
I mean, the smart grid is the death grid, is the slave grid. And does anyone listening out there really want to be part of this?
Yeah, so this whole idea of sharing this information with health insurers, you know, I first revealed this in 2004, where I found out that Stop and Shop, our biggest chain in New England, was actually sharing shopper card information with health insurance companies.
They're selling it.
In that case, they said, because I asked them, I was in a meeting and I asked the VP of technology, why are you doing this? Why are you collecting all this information? Why are you converting it into nutritional health records? They now have programs where everything they scan, they instantly add all the calories, all the, you know, every ingredient, it all gets tallied up for your individual profile. And I said, why are you doing that? He said, we hope to recoup some of the money we've spent by sharing that information with HMOs. And they can use it to raise your rates, cancel your policy. And once we get into Obamacare, this is where this gets really frightening. Once we hit Obamacare and I'm paying for your health insurance and that guy over there's health insurance and he's paying for mine, then it's going to be an argument that...
they already do it. They go...
Because that guy's eating the wrong food.
No. That's the collectivist model. Now it doesn't matter that you pay for your own plan. Now, everyone gets to decide because we're all together. It's the equivalent of having everyone in the world living in your house.
Yeah. And
no privacy, no nothing. Every control freak over you. A bunch of ninnies bossing each... But then never any concern in what we're eating with the HMOs. They're not worried about aspartame, GMO. It's all about the calories.
The calories. And, you know, there are people in that world who are sincere and really do want to see people be healthy.
Useful idiots.
Yeah. But the underlying issue is going to be an issue of we have unthinkingly allowed the creation of a food registration network. It's global. In Jamaica, they have frequent shopper cards. In Czechoslovakia, they have them. In South Korea, they have them. Everywhere you go in the globe now, there is software installed at the cash register.
And they push you to get them everywhere. Push them everywhere. Explain just in a nutshell before we go to calls, the scam in them. Why they started them.
Yeah, well, they started them for two reasons. One was to collect your data so they'd know everything you bought so that they could follow your household and make sure that you don't get coupons for the things you buy. So, you know, I remember back when when I was a little girl, my mom would clip coupons for the stuff we bought. We had a cat, so she'd clip Nine Lives coupons. Well, what the industry now says is we want to make sure that you never again get a coupon for anything you buy because you're going to buy it anyway. Why would we give you a discount?
So they know you, and then even the mailing list, or they have actuaries on everybody. And this is admitted. It's all a way to screw you.
Yeah, so, and especially in that marketing sense. So now you get a coupon for Friskies. And then they sit back and see if you actually cash it in, if you actually used it. And then they can say, well, look, we moved 15% of people over to this other brand. So it's all a plan. Even the RFID fridge. The Procter & Gamble had an internal document that we found in spy chips. Procter & Gamble said, we want to hook up your fridge, your smart refrigerator, to your television cable network. So when you remove the last can of Coke, your TV runs an ad for Pepsi.
And that was like 10 years ago.
Yes. And then
but see, now that's what they admit they're doing.
It's all actually occurring.
It is a master technocratic prison planet takeover.
Everything that we predicted in Spy Chips, and I would encourage people, G. Edward Griffin's book on...
The Federal Reserve.
Thank you. Everything that we wrote about in there in 2006 is all happening today. It's all coming.
And again, to everybody in the system... So many, there's different types. There's not just those in denial or those that accept it. Then there's bureaucrat types that go, yeah, I know it's happening. You don't like it, do you? They're like a little kid imagining they're Batman. They're imagining they're a winner and they're part of it when the system's attacking them.
Oh, yeah.
It's a system that wants you dead, idiots. You're not part of the winning team. You either join humanity and wake up and get your butt right with God or you join the devil. Because listen, even if you don't believe in the devil, this might as well be the devil. Okay, even if the devil isn't physically or spiritually real, the New World Order is the worst of the worst. It is the devil. You understand? It's kind of like Ray Kurzweil says, I don't believe in God yet. He believes he's going to become God and merge with the computer as the head of Google's head of technology. And you can laugh. This guy's running your life and mine too. Okay, listen, even if you don't believe in the devil believes in you, and I'll take his thing and turn it back. Ray Kurzweil doesn't believe in God. He believes in the devil and believes he will become the devil. They believe they're building God, but they're really building the devil. Even if you're an atheist, can you get this in your head? Could humans build something that acted like the devil and took over and did horrible things? A global control grid that wants to kill you. That's the devil. Kill, steal, and destroy. So they're building the devil. They're building the devil. The devil's real, folks. They're building the devil. I mean, isn't that a revelation?
I think it is. And you know who got it? Tolkien got it. You know, you think about the Lord of the Rings.
The Ring of Power.
Right. They were building it so that Sauron could occupy it. You know, many people throughout history have understood this, that humanity will build something. And once that something is built, then the evil consciousness will then embody itself into it and then enslave humanity.
Well, that's how it's always worked.
Absolutely. It is.
Tell Sauron... Build me an army.
Yeah.
You know, worthy of Mordor.
Yeah. So...
The power of Isengard is at your command.
You do that well. So, yes, it is definitely coming. And, you know, to get back to the Titanic analogy, we've got to tell people to get in the lifeboat. And as far as I'm concerned, that lifeboat, the only thing that's going to save you is that saving blood of Jesus Christ. That's it. Because everything else, I mean, this thing wants our blood. It wants to eat us. The Bible tells us it comes to destroy and devour, eat, consume. That's the reason why battlefields, that's why
the high priest, blood. The high priest, it says the magicians of Babylon, you pull the quotes up, trafficked in the souls of men.
Yeah.
That's what they want, is your soul. They want to know what you're into and they want to manipulate what you're into.
Oh.
I mean, they want your soul.
Well, that gets me to Google, knowing what you're into and manipulating it. Yeah. So, you know, one of the things, I don't know if you're familiar with the filter bubble.
Yes.
But this idea that Google...
It decides what you want now, but not really that, then it can distort that.
Yes. And it creates this notion, you ever have the feeling, and I'm sure your listeners have this feeling, that how could everybody not know this, that, and the other? You know, you look something up and your first 10 search results tell you exactly this, that you're
They are compartmentalizing, just like Romans compartmentalized Rome into 9 different ethnic groups to control them. So we're being compartmentalized, segregated.
We are. And what it does is those of us who are in the know of a certain kind of information, we find that every time we do a search on Google, we get more of that same information. And that causes us to become more and more incensed, more and more angry, and more, in a way, isolated. Because if you go out and you look at what your brother-in-law gets when he searches for the exact same thing on Google, he'll get a whole set of links that have nothing
to do with it. It's giving him the reality he wants.
Yes. So if we look up Monsanto based, well, I don't use Google, so it won't happen to me. But if somebody who uses Google regularly and listens to your show and looks up this kind of stuff, looks up Monsanto, they'll get Monsanto lawsuit and GMO damage and dead hamsters and all of that. But if somebody else looks up Monsanto, they'll get Monsanto stock values, Monsanto contributing to the betterment of Africa, Monsanto working with Bill Gates to do good things. So it's a different reality that we're seeing. And so when we wonder, why are they not waking up? It's because when we tell them things and they try to look them up, they get different answers.
That's right, because it already profiled what was keeping them in the matrix.
Yes.
And so they want us to think we're out there winning, putting us in our own matrix, but then it's worse than that. And David and I actually got shots of this. We have a bunch of YouTube channels, all total. It's like 600 million views, our channels and fan channels, but one of them got up to 300 million. And I saw a couple months ago, it had hit right at 300 million. And then I saw it at like 390. Now that I'm busy, whatever. And then at 380 million. And then 370 million. And they're just taking our views away. And I went and looked it up, and I already knew the reason. They're gaming at taking Sony's views away and stuff, so I have to pay them. But they're doing it across the board with the algorithm, even though we're not monetized. They don't get my little joke, is that we don't take their ads. But it doesn't matter. We don't have gamed views. But they just took 30 million views, and now it's more every day. Amazing. And then people that were already in our network, they all still get the subscription. But I talk to new people that subscribe, or people who just woke up, they don't get the subscription.
Ah.
I mean, think of how this is war-gamed.
It is.
I said we go to calls, but...
And, well, one last thing I do want to say is I'm not sure how much longer we're going to be able to rely on the internet in its present form.
Oh, they're already, they've said they're killing the old web.
And when you're talking about getting the word out, I did want to mention up in New Hampshire where I live, way up in the middle of nowhere, I was driving on a very lonely road, and then I headed onto a freeway, and I'm heading up in northern New Hampshire, and there goes two cars with InfoWars bumper stickers. And then 2 days later, I was in Amherst, New Hampshire, very conservative, very low-key community, and on the stop sign, someone had put an InfoWars sticker right across the stop sign. So you're getting the word out in ways that don't rely on Google reporting back or on YouTube reporting back, but on actual people doing tangible, actual things, and we need more of that.
Well, here's how I liken Google, since you use the Lord of the Rings, and that's why I talked about Sauron and Gandalf. They, and if you really read it, he was a genius, Tolkien, because what they are is that they're really angels in men's form. But Sauron's an evil, he's an angel that's decided to join Lucifer, or Morgoth, who is then Sauron. But if you actually read the lore of it, it's really interesting because the guy was a linguist and studied ancient religions and stuff. So that's what he was kind of inculcating, a Christian mythos into this larger thing. He was a Christian. But the issue is, he goes in and he says, where'd you get this crystal ball? That's dangerous. Those see both ways. Yeah. And Gandalf touches it and sees Sauron looking at him, even though it had a cloth over it.
It's like your TV now, right?
It's your TV. It's seeing both ways. So Google, but see, you're just seeing what you're looking for. Google's tying it into everything.
Yeah.
And so you are literally, that is a spider eye and a compound eye.
That's a beautiful way of putting it.
Of Lucifer. You are literally engaging Lucifer.
That is a brilliant way of putting it.
No, it is. You're giving Lucifer where you're going, what you're doing, everything you stand for. You are in a chamber with Lucifer looking right at you.
Yeah, so I guess you could think of Star Page then.
It's a real crystal ball. Did you know before I looked it up, I knew they called it a crystal ball. I had this epiphany about 7 years ago, and I looked it up and found white papers with Google scientists at MIT saying it will be a crystal ball where they can see the future in mass movements. And it turned out they have built crystal balls. That's what this is an interface to a crystal ball. But I'm only looking in from one position. It is networked into everything. Like you said, I'm sorry, I'm ranting. We're going to do Overdrive. How's that sound?
All right.
Never let you get any rest. Then you got to do the nightly news. We're going to wear Katherine Albrecht out. Your call's coming up. Stay with us. We're going right to your calls here. White House blames Big Sis for alien release. That's up at Drudge, drudgereport.com. And they already release illegal aliens all the time. It just shows how the globalists want open borders to bring people in politically, to drive down wages, and to then see themselves allied with the government when the government just wants to bring the country down to consolidate power. Dr. Katherine Albrecht's our guest. People have been patient holding. I'm going to go to Keith, and then we're going to go to Mike, Steve, Julius, and Mark. It's probably all the time we have. Real quick comment and question. Keith in Indiana, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I used to live in Lancaster, PA, about 4 years ago, and they had the largest number of cameras in the streets per population. And when people tried to protest against this, the two things we found out were that there were no Christians who attended the meetings, and the lawyers told us that you can't have any right of public expectancy of privacy in public.
Catherine's audio headpiece isn't working for some reason, but we'll try to get that hooked. Yeah, it just got unplugged when she got up and left. We got to watch that when people get up and down. We just go through the same issue every time people are live. I think we got a headset with guests or something, because this is like Groundhog Day. But that's basically the question. I mean, what is your overall point on that front, sir?
My point is that when I lived in a community that actually had the cameras everywhere, and you could walk from one end of town to the other and you were being watched on a camera, the conservative Christians didn't have anything to do with protesting against it. They just refused to do anything.
And that's because their churches are totally run by government agents. It's called clergy response teams. What's your thank you for the call, sir. Great point. What's your take on the mainline Christian church just saying, hey, take chips, cameras, take forced shots, everything's wonderful, forced abortion, it's all good, because we're all going to be teleported out of here with a rapture?
Yeah, you know, that's funny, because when we were protesting, I did a prayer vigil outside of the Alzheimer's facility where they were chipping the Alzheimer's patients, actually sticking it into the arms of grandma. They had 200 people that they were chipping. And I tried to find a local church in West Palm Beach, Florida that would have somebody come out and join me and lead the prayer. And I called church after, I got the phone book, and I called church after church after church. And they all said, either, we think that's a great idea. Why would you oppose that?
They're of the devil.
Or they said, well, you're showing a lack of faith by even objecting to that. Don't you know we're all going to be raptured away? So the Bible is very ambiguous.
They're going to accept
whether
the devil.
Whether there is or isn't a rapture, it doesn't matter.
You're to fight evil.
I got to say that if the folks who believe in a rapture are wrong, then here's what's going to happen. When it actually does come time to either put your head in the guillotine and be beheaded or take the mark of the beast, you know that the devil's going to be saying to all the Christians who believed in the rapture,
no, this is Jesus.
They're going to say, no, they're actually going to say, your God isn't real. He didn't save you. That's all a fairy tale.
Oh, these people, it's so demonic, these churches. Well, let's jam in a call, Julius. No. First up was Mike in Tennessee, 1600 AM, WMQM, I believe, is the call letters. Go ahead, Mike.
Good afternoon, Dr. Jones and Dr. Albright. February 4th was a deadline for completing your United States 2012 Census of Agriculture, which required you to list everything that you have on any piece of farming property, animals, and everything. And yesterday was the deadline.
Yeah, I don't fill any of it out. It's all fraudulent. And they lie and say, U.S. code, you have to do it. U.S. code, you just got to see how many people live there. It's all a fraud. But yeah, the census is part of this.
This is the agriculture census. Yesterday was the deadline for the Federal Animal Disease Traceability Rule. It took effect yesterday, requiring tattooing, tagging, and otherwise marking of every animal.
Hey, well, stay there. I'm going to come back to you. We're doing a little bit of overdrive, but let me just explain something to everybody, okay? We have a ranch. We have a farm. The animal ID, the premises ID, it's all color of law. They tell you it's the law to vaccinate your kids. There is no law in any state in the union. There's a waiver you get for it, but it's not even a waiver to a law, it's a regulation. It's a hoax. And yes, I'm aware of all that. We'll come right back to you, but this is part of the takeover of the food supply. Stay with us. Katherine Albrecht's also going to be on the nightly news tonight. I think Melissa Melton's hosting it. I meant to get to all your calls. It's so much important information. Mike in Tennessee, listening on 1600 AM. We got a lot of affiliates in Tennessee. That's a great affiliate right there. But Mike, go ahead and make your point, sir.
I'm just looking at the incrementalism, and as Catherine was talking earlier about how they enact this stuff, and then they immediately come out with the follow-up. And, yeah, everybody needs to wake up. I mean, there was on the news the other night, they were showing car crashes in Germany, where in Germany every car has a dashboard cam. So they can, in real time, see what's going on from the dashboard of your cars. They no longer need cameras over the interstates. Every car is a moving
I saw Toyota like 6 years ago say in the future a camera will watch you and call the police if your kid isn't in a seatbelt, and the computer is smart and knows if they are. I mean, it's like 1984 times 10. And it's like, oh, what's the big deal? I mean, it's crazy. Just like I told people 15 years ago, OnStar listens to you. Later it came out. Well, I had an FBI source on that.
They did. And, you know, in San Antonio, we saw a vision of the future yesterday when we visited the vendor of this RFID tracking program, because they pulled up a screen for us. And on the screen, you could see the circles of the school. And then they could click on a circle and tell you how many people were in it. And then they could click and show you their picture, their school ID number, their grade, their name, all their personal information came up. And as we were driving, I stopped at a traffic light. I said, in the future, there's going to be a circle, and the police are going to be able to pull up a circle of the entire city and click that intersection and know everybody who's there. And the only thing missing to make that possible is for all of us to carry the device that links into the global brain, and then it's done. So I actually saw the future yesterday. It was very.
And again, they say, what's wrong with that? It's convenient. The global brain's run by the devil.
Yeah, well, there you go.
I mean, It's like, hey, it's just a babysitter. It's a cannibal. What's wrong with the babysitter? It's a guy, next door neighbor's a cannibal. Yeah. He's a convicted cannibal.
Not a good.
Just got out of jail for 40 years. It's like the guy running the machine. It's not nice.
Not a good babysitter. Exactly. And that's the whole thing. If we could actually trust government and we could trust our fellow human being to be perfect,
this stuff would be great.
Then it'd be great. You'd go, sure, that sounds like a perfect idea. But the reality, we have thousands.
Yeah, it's
of
like, hey, history. Let's keep mentally ill people from having guns. The problem is, you're on record want all our guns.
Yeah.
Stop trying to sound reasonable.
Well, and how long before they say we're mentally ill? Because
they're already doing that. Let's jam in another one. Steve in Pennsylvania, listening via InfoWars audio streams. Go ahead, sir.
Hey, Alex. How are you?
Good, buddy. Go ahead and talk to Katherine.
All right. Hey, I've been trying for the past 2 weeks to call in, and I just keep getting hit with, you know, the busy signals and everything else. So I was able to get in. I've been in the military for 6 years. I'm currently a college student. I've been taking political science. I've been up in the ante on everything and anything, you know, that I read, that I hear. I've done a lot of research online with the whole, you know, Sandy Hook thing and the whole weapons confiscation that they want to push, that they're trying to push down in the Beltway. You know, I'm drawing my line in the sand. They ain't getting my guns.
I know, and they know that. So that's and do you have a question? Go ahead.
Yeah, with the 2 billion bullets, they're federal non-military agencies and organizations, right? They're getting the 2 billion bullets.
It's every federal agency that packs heat.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's non-military, yes.
All right. You know, with being in the military, you start to see a lot more of what's really going on. A lot of the kids in my political classes I've had in college, they didn't know a damn thing when you get down to it. I mean,
no, they're children. The public watches TV and knows how to act cool at a party. They don't know how the world works. I'm out of time, brother, and I'm sorry the other callers. Retransmission starts now. I wanted to hear about smart meters from Mark in Canada and others, but Catherine's got to go tape for the nightly news, because they tape the interviews and do the news part live. So she's got to go because her own show's coming up.
Brave New Books.
Absolutely. Brave New Books tonight.
7 p.m.
And her own
show. Austin.
You bet. It's down on Guadalupe. All our listeners know where that's at. And she's got to do her own show coming up in an hour.